And welcome everybody to the Saints Tech Cosmocast. I'm your host Ramses, and with me per usual is Benkos.
Hi everybody, we're back from the underworld.
And also I got Jackie.
Hello everybody. Back from burning in the sun.
Mm-hmm. It is really hot right now, but hey, you know, we'll survive. It's going to be evening soon in a lot of places, and so that's going to at least help us out a little bit when it comes to, like, the...
Yeah, right. We're talking about here being 30°C outside when it's 9 o'clock, 10
okay.
o'clock at night.
Okay, I'll take that. I unlike other people, I will take that L. I will be like, yo, I will take that L if in case something goes wrong. So, yeah, I will definitely take that L for that. But yeah, obviously, of course, if you're not aware, I took a brief break. I took about a month break. There are some changes happening here on the side, but I think a lot of these changes for the better. And also, taking the break was very beneficial for me. We didn't stop paying attention to the Saints Day news. That's a good news. Like, we understand what's going on. We know that there was a lot of stuff that happened in that time that we're taking that break. And we're going to address a lot of that stuff. There's not too much stuff, but there's a lot of important things that we need to discuss first and foremost. But I do really appreciate all the support, everybody just checking up on me, all the well wishes, like say, hey, you know, thanks a lot for, you know, I just want to say, hey, thank you so much for your support, your continued support, especially during that time. That month was really, really needed. That month was just the perfect time for me to just, like, do what I needed to do, my own thing, which I did. I started learning how to hand paint model kits. I've been working on a lot of model kits, and I've been fooling around doing stuff like this a little bit more, because I wanted to do a lot more with, like, integration with Twitch and stuff like that, because I feel like this is a good place too, like, just in case that we... You know, if things fall through, or I want this to be another venue for us, the fans, to check out as well. Anyways, as I was saying, so yeah, it's been a really good time for us to just relax, check ourselves, do some changes around, and like I said, like find something else to do. And
it's good to be back.
Yeah,
have you back.
Yeah, and not just that, too. Like, all I can say is right now, too, is when we get to the episodes today, it made me feel really nostalgic, and it made me really want to do the show a lot more when I started doing this. And I'll get to why we started doing the episode discussion, because this particular part of the series, this Asgard arc, has a lot of meaning to me. I know, and it's so weird for a filter arc to have that much impact, but it's really good, really good. And I can't wait to discuss a lot of things with it. So when we get to that episode discussion, we'll be doing that as well. Another thing we'll be discussing today is something that we were talking about, like, off air, like, you know, during the off time, which was a discussion about Saint Seiya in English. A lot of people were like, it was inspired by Maru, who posted a video about it on his YouTube channel. And while he had a lot of great info, there's still a lot of stuff that was kind of, like, omitted, or, like, it's not really that well-known. And I kind of want to, like, talk a lot about that. As we're going along. Also, as you can see, I'm recording this on YouTube. I'm recording this on Twitch. So if you haven't checked out Twitch, it's at twitch.tv/lramses84. Not only are we going to be recording here, but also I still do my own thing here as well. So if you can give me a follow, that would be great. All right, then. Let's get started with the news, then. First bit of news. We finally got some info on the new... we finally got info for the September release of Time Odyssey here in the United States. It's going to come out in September. And it's gonna come with two covers. It's gonna come out in two covers, just as the last time. The two covers are gonna be made by. It's gonna be my first cover, and the one you should be seeing on screen is by It's gonna be made by Chris Lee. It's a picture of Ikki like just wearing his cloth and that really cool style that they're using for this series, where it's like he's kind of like wearing a gunmetal gray with yellow highlights. It looks so cool. And so it's like a bit of the manga style, but also a bit of like the Guillermo del Toro style as well that he's been using as well. And the second cover is made by Gerald Parrell. And it's just the all the four major saints and Athena, and they're all in their manga in all of their manga colors in their manga outfits. Yeah, we're gonna get it in September. It surprised the heck out of me that we're gonna get the second issue this quickly. But any thoughts on anything? Oh, one last thing. Yeah, in addition to these covers, you're gonna get the Guillermo del Toro cover as well. And we already have an idea now how this is gonna be played out. Because we already got more information how this is gonna be made. And it's gonna be made how like the Japanese version was, where it's like it's gonna be 32 pages each issue. So you're not gonna get the complete book, but you're gonna get at least like a part of the book. But Becca, you've been following Time Odyssey very closely. What are your thoughts on this so far?
I really, really want those variant covers. It's just beautiful. I'm staring at it and like I can't believe just how well it looks. It's here's the thing. I'm not accustomed to seeing like the well-established. You get used to after a while, even though Sensei has so many spin-offs, and technically speaking, many different authors have given their take on the classic characters. In a way, your brain kind of adjusts to saying, well, yeah, but those are official art styles, right? And your brain gets used to seeing those images after a while. And my brain is just at awe at seeing a new official variant take on these characters that I just wasn't expecting it, and I'm very happy for that. As for the way that it's going to be handled, I think that it makes sense. I don't know why they would choose that release form, since in everywhere else, that has been released, the book has been like the contained volume. Here being separate, I don't see it as a bad thing being separated into two different volumes for the original one. So it even feels better than now that we're gonna have this variant cover to accompany it. So I'm actually surprised also that September is ironically the month that it's gonna be coming out in the US, considering the other bit of news that we're gonna be talking about a little bit later. But I am happy that it's gonna get released, and I'm gonna try my best to see if I can get those versions as well to have them in my collection.
I'll do my best on my end to see if I can try to get those for you, but I think by the time this comes out, like the concert will already be set. So, they haven't said like exactly when. I want to say it's the second week of September it's gonna come out, and that might be a little bit cutting a little too close to like the upcoming concert, because I want to get a few things out to you guys before we go out before the concert like starts. Jackie, any thoughts on this bit of news?
I could actually miss this news. I just saw it like maybe a little bit later than when I saw your teeth. But I'm glad it's actually coming out next month the first one comes out, right?
Yes.
I'm trying to remember the name. Okay, so they're actually doing one. So is it gonna be like three volumes for the book that would make up the whole book?
I would assume so, because I think what they're trying to do is like I think they want to keep the because like this is just a practice by this is just a practice in all comic industry. Like this is not just a isolated incident. I think what's going on is that it is more of an issue that in order for them to get the maximized profits from whatever they're doing, they're gonna have to they're gonna have to separate it into it, and they're gonna make more money out of the flop, as we call them, the floppies. As opposed to where the real money is with the actual books, because like the actual books, it's a weird conversation involving like with how previews works, and how like Dicronian their kind of rule is on like how they distribute stuff. It's a huge mess. It's a huge mess with comic books, and this is not something that I don't think this is the right venue to talk about that kind of stuff. All I gotta say is they're banking a lot on those floppies. That's why they're kind of releasing these like as individual books here in the United States and in the United States especially, because it's a good way for them to just maximize the profits from those individual issues.
It sounded like to me. I mean, and I can see why. For one thing, you know, not from giving us like the whole story one shot, people are gonna be like, "Ooh, what happens next?" You know, creating that cliffhanger and having multiple covers. I mean, I think it's having that right effect that makes people, "Ooh, hey, I like this one more. I like that one more."
Yeah,
I want to collect them all. So, like, you know, it's up front. It looks like you, because we know that this was a whole book, you know, and so that's a whole book in France and.
I think
Spanish releases in Japan, it got split into two, but we get the sort of comic book thing. It's not a bad thing at all, and I like it. So I just hope that the fact we're in it so fast that it does well.
Yeah, and another thing that I like too is like it's something that Bank has brought up, and that is the fact that we're seeing new artwork, official artwork from. People that we don't get to see artwork from. Like, Gerard Pardell, he used to do a lot of stuff with Marvel, but currently he's working with Riot. So he's working right now with League of Legends. And, like, he's doing a lot of work with League of Legends right now, and, so he's really famous right now in that LOL scene. I'm pretty sure, too, he's working on Project L as well, which is, I can't wait, but so I'm pretty sure a lot of people are going to get attention from that. Just as I like the last time we had the covers by David Mack, who worked on a lot of stuff for Marvel and was working on like a lot of title sequences for Marvel, a lot of MCU movies. You know, we're getting all this crazy art from like these really top rated creators shared from the United States. Like that's I think like the best part in my opinion. Like just seeing all this official art from these sources that are well known here in the United States. The premier part of like who makes a lot of these comic books, and I would love to see like more like as much as I want to see like these kind of artwork, these kinds of like work, these anime-ish kind of works, I would love to like see if like can get like John Romita Jr. or like Todd McFarlane just to see if like they want to do a couple of covers. That'd be so crazy if they can. But that's just
you never know.
That would be really something to see if it happens. One can wish.
Yeah, one can very much wish. But yeah, like I said, the whole issue about them splitting the books is a whole complicated issue altogether. But, you know, I see this as an opportunity to have, like, something physical with these covers as well. You know, I am definitely going to pick up, like, I'm going to definitely pick up both of these covers because I think they're really nice, especially the first cover by Chris Lee. That cover is incredible. Incredible! I love it so much. As a matter of fact, I am like tempted to buy like a myth cloth and just repaint it to look like that. I am very close, or I might actually buy like the, I might actually buy like the anime heroes and just use that. Because like you know, I've been learning how to paint a little bit more. So like, don't be shocked if something pops up on your feed. But any final thoughts on this? Any final thoughts on this? Next?
I suppose I've already pretty much said what I was thinking about it. I'm really happy to see this. Like, it genuinely makes me happy to see different artists that give their take on this franchise, particularly artists from the US. It's something that I did not ever thought could happen, so it makes me happy that it has.
Jackie, any final thoughts?
Looking forward to it. I mean, you know, it's, we're getting Saint stuff in English. You know, I was thinking at first that it was going to be quite a while before we heard about Volume 2 for the Time Odyssey. And hey, it's only going to be a month wait. So, you know, more than likely, we won't have to wait that long for Part 3.
And, okay, so I guess I already revealed this on Twitter, but I can talk about it here a little bit. I'm going to be at San Diego Comic-Con, and I'm going to, I hope they're there, and I can do, and that, you know, something's there, and, like, you know, we can, and, you know, we, and I can check more, I can get more information out, but, like, I do hope that A-Blaze is going to be there to, like, you know, I hope there's someone there to, like, and I get to see a lot of that stuff, like, in person, so, if, like, there is, I'll keep you guys informed, But if not, I'm just gonna go enjoy the convention. Just like, hey, I like different stuff. But when that time comes, I will be discussing more about that. Anyways, let's go on to our next topic. Speaking of Time Odyssey, Time Odyssey Volume 2, the official Volume 2, it's gonna be coming out in September 18th in France, I believe, right?
Yes.
So it's gonna be
much cooler.
So in September. we do know for a fact that like a lot of these books I think you said because each book who is gonna be on the cover it's gonna be someone they're gonna be focusing on. In this case, the main character we're gonna be focusing on this book is gonna be Shun, I believe. So yes. Is there anything else I'm missing about this particular bit of news?
I don't remember if we told this when we originally, because the news of the second volume being in the works, we mentioned that previously, but we did not have a release date for it. In fact, I think even though the release date has been confirmed, I'm not sure that the image that has been circulating on the webs is like the final cover for it. I think it's still in the works. Maybe we'll have to wait and see. But the last thing that we touched upon this, we knew that it was coming, but not the date for it. As Ramses was mentioning, indeed, every volume is going to be focused on a particular Bronze Saint. The volume 1 is focused on Ikki, volume 2 is going to be focused on Shun, and the subsequent volumes. As far as I can remember, the original intent is to do 5. There is no change of plans as far as... Jerome hasn't given any news or any hints that could change. The likelihood of Seiya being the last one is the most likely. It is. It's gonna tell, and like those 5 volumes tell self-contained stories, but that are telling an overall arcing story for them. So that's gonna be interesting. And apparently, because for example, the volume 1, without spoiling anything about the story itself, takes place before the 12 temples fight begins, time-wise. And the second volume is going to take place after the battle at Sanctuary. So it's going to be interesting to see how Jerome takes the story with these characters in these different time frames and how the overall arcing story is going to take place unfolding upon all of them. But yeah, so far, that's the only thing that we can confirm about the story, that it's going to be focused more on Shun. Doesn't necessarily mean that the other characters will not appear on it, but the focus and the main character of said volume will be Shun for this one.
Any thoughts on this bit of news, Jackie?
I might be wrong, but I could have sworn that maybe I'm confusing it with something else. I thought I'd seen an image of Mu that was going to be on that volume as well. Probably me, I'm mistaken.
No, that's an official thing. There is an image of... I think Mu is going to be making an appearance.
Oh, okay, so it was for Chima. Okay, I wasn't sure about that.
I'm always down for more Mu.
How long has it been since it came out last year, right?
Volume 1, yes.
So it's been about a year.
I believe Volume 1 came out in December, I believe? Just before?
No, I think it came out... It was between August and September, I remember.
Okay, never mind. So, I could have swore like the actual book came out in December. But then again, too, like we were seeing stuff as early as August. Because I remember seeing a lot of stuff in like the Japanese, they were giving it out as a supplement in like Shonen Red. So I
think it may have come out first over there.
Yeah, it appeared first on the Champion Red before the official release in France.
That's right.
Yeah, and I believe like when it finally came out like officially in its book form, I believe it came out in like December. That's all I was saying, in the format. So it's like we're looking at like what, once every 6 to 8 months every book. But if it's like one guy working on this, then take all the time you need. That's all I gotta say. Like don't overdo it. Especially since I know a lot of people who work in the industry. Just don't stress out over it. But yeah, I'm excited. I'm really excited to see where this book is gonna go. Like, you know, with us knowing that we're gonna be getting the stuff in the United States, it makes me even more excited to pick to see what's gonna happen next. And I really want to check out what's gonna be happening in the actual book.
Yeah, I'm going to guess that Jerome is probably trying to roughly keep a schedule about a book per year, you know. More or less, of course, you know, give or take some time. And maybe that was one of the reasons why it took us, you know, about this long just to get it. I guess they want to allow enough time for, you know, so that Ablaze can do the translation, localization, all that good stuff, you know. Allow themselves enough time in between.
Yeah, that so it's like, yeah, so I'm very sure too that like there's gonna be a lot. I'm pretty sure too another big factor is them Guillaume working with Kurumada Pro as well. I'm pretty sure there's a lot of back and forth. It's like how they're gonna be playing off a lot of stuff that Kurumada had in mind and stuff like that. So I'm pretty sure there's a lot of back and forth that they got to do before they put everything into ink.
Yeah, so they have to allow that. But, you know, at the end of the day, the important thing is that we're getting it in English, you know, because, I mean, of course, it goes, you know, all I know with all the news, well, we're covering today, you know, people saying, oh, things say, you know, is then the U.S., who cares? Well, you know, if the fact that we're getting, you know, these books, it just shows you that there is interest. It's maybe a slow start, but it's there, you know. So, keep it up and, you know, hopefully, you know, more companies take notice, and this is just the beginning of more, they say, things we're getting, because we're also getting something along the lines of fun, right?
Hopefully.
Yeah.
Fun. So.
I'm pretty sure someone's laughing, and someone's laughing right now.
Fun Co!
Wait, hold on. Let me see. That's not next on the list. That's not listed on the list. Hold on. You're getting ahead of yourself. You're getting way too ahead of yourself. But yeah, because there's other things we got to discuss too. But yeah, I'm excited. Like I said, I'm excited to see where the story is going to go to next. Because pretty much described it really well, and I cannot wait to. I cannot wait to read what's happening next. Alright. Speaking of toys, but not quite Funko just yet. Holy moly! We got a lot of Saint Seiya news from Tamashii Nations from the Mexico leg of the tour.
It was quite packed. Oh. Quite packed. Oh, packed, and I regret not attending it.
No, that's fine. That's perfectly fine because we got to see a lot of the news, anyways. And like I'm disappointed that they didn't show up one thing, but I'm surprised at the amount of things that they did talk about. Okay. First thing first, we're getting reissues of the classic five Bronze Saints in new pearlescent paint jobs. They look more anime accurate, in my opinion, and. In Japan, they're gonna be Tamashii Nation, Tamashii Web exclusive figures, and I believe everywhere else they're gonna be like normally available. And I'm pretty sure because like they would not be able to, they're not gonna skip Mexico. Like that's money on the floor. They cannot get back. Second of all, we got our first glimpse of our EX deluxe set of Athena in both her regular form and with her cloth that you see at the very end of the series, which is very cool in my opinion. We're also gonna get a couple of EX revivals of Gemini, Capricorn. Oh my god! Hold on, let me ring it up.
Milo.
Yeah, Milo.
Deathmask just released the revival.
I got the list right here. I skipped it over. I'm going too quick. Stop scrolling. Milo and Deathmask and Saga. I believe also Mu as well is getting one as well.
Already got one.
Okay.
He's already out.
Okay. Here's the one. It's Saga, Camus. It's just Saga and Camus for right now, and also like Saga and Camus, and I believe, like you said, Shaka. And yeah, those are the next figures to get the revival treatment. And also, wait,
but Camus just came out. Not that
long. I think it was lumped in with like the stuff because I think it just came out. Like it barely came out like within the time frame of it. So it's, they kind of classified it as a figure. That's something as part of that release. And finally, they were taking votes on like, I don't know why they said, I don't know why on the website, I don't know why on the when I first saw it, it said there July 16th. But no, it was actually June 16th. Since June 16th till August 31st, they're taking votes on which figure you want to get reissued into the series. And there's various figures that are being thrown around here. We got Siegfried of Alpha Delta. We got here Papillon Miru. We got Hades. We got Solo Gold Iorios, Poseidon. We got the first Mythcloth EX of Saga. And Marin as some of the figures that are being considered for reissue. And I think that's the figure, the sale figure, that's the EX figure, I believe.
Yeah, probably the B2.
So yeah. So you can vote on those. I'll post a link to that and you can get your votes heard on the website. And finally, we're gonna be getting even more info going into like 2024. They said like they're gonna be spreading out a lot of these releases going forward. So you got these two releases, and then in July we're gonna be getting even more, and then in August as well. I'm pretty sure I wouldn't be shocked that one of these places where they're gonna be announcing this stuff might be soon, the Comic Con, hint hint. But yeah, any thoughts on all of this bit of toy news? Bankos.
My wallet is weeping.
I think all of our... Because
there are many of those figures that I want. I'm kind of on the fence on the B1s because let's be clear about this. This is not like EX versions of the B1 clots. This is the regular myth clots that are getting a revival. So even though the quality for them is going to be much better than the original release, which already, like those myth clots, the regular ones, were already pretty good by that time, it's still not the size and still not the level of detail that most of the EX figures have been able to acquire. So it's kind of something that makes, like, if you are somebody that collects that thing, those figures, you're probably going to get them, but it's something to take into consideration. And also, these figures are probably going to, I would hope that Bandai has a little bit of foresight to do a decent number to run them, because those are probably some of the most popular versions of the clots. I don't fancy the B1s too much, to truth be told, from the anime, but I'm in the minority here. So those figures are those versions of the clot are very loved and are very well desired by people, both collectors and general, maybe somebody that just wants to have the figure on their room. So hopefully that they will have enough stock of them. As for Athena, it's just the only thing that I can say is about goddamn time. The EX line is over 10 years old, and just now we're getting Athena on an EX form. Better late than never, but still.
Don't say it was 10 years. Oh my god, I'm crumbling to dust.
That's exactly how I felt when I was researching that. Like,
Because I remember when they announced that, they announced the EX with like the Solo Gold figures, and they announced the Crown figures as well. And just like, I remember that. And it's like, don't tell me. I thought that was 5 years ago, but tell me now. You tell me 10 years ago. I'm just like,
It's been a while. It's been a while.
But keep going.
So yeah, so I'm really happy that we're finally gonna get Athena with her God Claw, and that it looks fantastic. I really want that figure. I hope to get the set, but I know that's going to be very difficult, so I'm kind of already grinding my teeth figuring out how I'm going to get that set with both her regular Sayori regular clothes and with her cloth. So I'm hoping to get that, and it's going to be one of those items that it's going to be fought over by collectors, trust me on that. For the other figures, well, I keep hoping that more of the revivals are coming out. I would like to complete my EX collection, so hopefully more of them get released, because some of those figures are very difficult to find, or in the aftermarket, they're very much overpriced. And, yeah, So it's something that actually makes me happy to see all these figures getting announced. There's still a lot of potential there. Bandai and Toei just gotta put their heads together and do a good job.
Jackie, do you have any thoughts on the current stuff that just got announced here at the Tamashii Nation leg of the Mexican tour?
Why the hell couldn't they have announced this in December, damn it? You realize that's when I bought my Athena?
Oh, no!
That's why I was growling!
Oh my god, that sucks!
Because I asked around, they said no, and I don't think we'll see her. That's what in a group I'm on Facebook with it for figures. They're like, no, I don't think we won't see her. It's gonna be either really expensive, which definitely hit on that one, but they weren't expecting it to like late next year. And they're like, oh no, we're gonna release. They announced it, and it's gonna be for the 7th. I'm like, son of a jackal.
But yeah.
So now I'm really saying, like, well, I got out of the pins, but I'm like, do I try to go for her after all? I mean, she looks gorgeous, but what is it going to be like around $250? Ouch.
Maybe, yeah. If you want the EX set with the cloth, yeah, I'm pretty sure we're looking at like $200.
Do I try to maybe just look for an older? Like the older, that's just the Saori version, because I have Athena Goddess, because I'm also trying to do something like a custom figure, so either I could keep this one for spare, maybe use it for my customs, and then I get that new one, because it really does looks gorgeous.
Well, but, I mean, you can go to I won't condone this. I will absolutely not condone what I'm about to say next. So, like, whatever I do, this is not something that this show is sponsored or anything like that. But, you know, you can go to, like, you know, Alibaba or something like that, and just, or AliExpress, and just, like, you know, pick up some of those, like, third-party ones. if you really want those, because, like, I am not condoning piracy or anything like that, but, you know, I've seen some of them, and they're like, you know, from a distance, they can pass. If you're gonna do stuff like customize stuff, I would suggest you not investing too much on them. That's
no,
just
I
me.
No. I mean, I actually bought stuff from AliExpress, but it was like I bought one of the. Since we're talking about figures, you know the Holy Contract, Soria waifus. I got one of them.
Oh no!
I'm making a costume.
Okay.
So that's why I got it. No, I'm not using the Athena. No, I'm not touching my Athena. What I did do for my Athena, I made her a costume. I made her a skirt, an actual fabric skirt. So she looks really nice.
I think I've seen a lot of your work on Twitter. It looks really cool, though. Like all the custom stuff, like all the custom cape stuff and stuff like that. Stuff like that, believe it or not, is really cool that someone's doing, because I'm always, okay. Like full disclosure, mm-hmm. Like this is gonna be Ramsey's time. Like give me a minute or two to self indulge here.
Sure.
I collect toys. I collect a lot of action figures from like everything. I collect Transformers. I collect G.I. Joes. Another thing I like collecting is I like collecting stuff from DC Comics, especially the stuff that's currently being released right now, like McFarlane. A lot of that mm-hmm. stuff is really good. The problem is, Todd McFarlane doesn't believe in cloth capes. So you can make a killing if you can make a Superman cape. I'm pretty sure you're gonna get a whole line of people asking for one. I guarantee it. You can like make your money back instantly if you're saying, "Hey, I'm making a cape. I'm making a cape for a 7-inch Superman."
That's the thing. I mean, I'm not really a good. I can only sew by hand. I'm really bad at it. My mom, she's the one that goes. But you know, I'm just trying it because somebody offered to make me that, and the price they wanted to charge me, I'm like, no, okay, I'm not the best, but I can probably do this. And I ended up refurbishing like a really old Barbie doll dress that was falling apart, but the portion that I used for the skirt was still in good condition, and that's what happened. But yeah. That's one of my little side projects. I'm going to see if I can make a custom figure like based on my own Santian. And no, for that, that's why I bought one of those Holy Contract ones and bootleg.
Yeah.
Like, sorry. No, I'm not going to use the actual one. But yeah, I don't know. I may just pass up in there. As nice as it looks, I mean, I have my... As gorgeous as it looks, I do have my Athena, and I'm really happy with her. She's right here taking up a good chunk of my desk right now.
I know that feeling. I know that feeling, but like not with Saint Seiya figures, but like I'm staring at like a shelf full of Transformers, and I'm like, I got more coming in. I don't know how these guys are just gonna be falling off the shelf, just gonna be hanging on to dear life at this point. Any final thoughts on this bit of news or twice in general, Bankos?
A part of me wants to say, please stop, my wallet can't take it anymore, but another part of me says, please go on, give me more. So there's hoping that I can get those figures, that's all I can say right now.
Jackie, any final thoughts?
Thanks, you jerks. Stop machinations.
Okay. One last thing I wanted to say. The thing I was disappointed on. We were teased back in New York that we were going to get stuff for the movie. And they didn't show shit!
You're right. They haven't.
The only thing we've seen was like the pendant, but I don't know if that pendant is like a prop from the movie or it's something they could actually sell. That's my problem. And I would kill for that pendant. If you said, hey, we're selling that, we're just selling the pendant. And we're selling the pendant for like $35. Here's my fucking wallet. Give me 20.
Okay, maybe they do make an Athena from the movie. I'll forgive to that machination.
Like, I'll get like seriously, like I'm like rubbing my credit card on the. I'll rub my credit card in front of my freaking monitor. If they say, hey, you can buy the pendant, because like I love bullshit. I love bullshit like that. I live for like role playing items, like I like rider belts and like transformation devices from Sentai, or like weapons from like animes and stuff like that. That's my jam. That is my absolute favorite jam. And I'm happy that there's at least something from Saint Seiya that feeds that insect part of my brain that wants role play items. Like, cause like I have a couple of guns. I have a couple of Nerf guns from like Guardians of the Galaxy. I have a few Henshin belts. I'm eyeing the new Henshin belt from Shin Kamen Rider. Oh god, just give me all the roleplay stuff. Just give it to me, damn it.
Okay. Yeah, that reminds me. I gotta send you that package with that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Anyway. Hey! Oh god, that's right! Oh god, that's right!
I'm sorry, I forgot. Okay, I'm gonna.
No, I completely forgot that. I completely forgot. And for a good reason. Like I said, I was doing my own thing, but like, I completely forgot. I will discuss it off stream later, but oh my god, that's another stupid transformation.
You can do like a Sailor Moon type transformation?
Oh my god, do you know like how, you know, I'm a 30. Okay. I'm 39 years old. I kill for a Sailor Moon Henshin wand or a Henshin device. Seriously, because like every time I want to get one, I have no money and I don't want to pay a third party stuff for it. Oh my god. Okay, we gotta get off the topic. We gotta get off. Oh my god, we got more toys. Jackie, please, like since you're the one who brought it up the last time, why don't you take over on this one and you get us started this one while I curl up in a ball and cry?
Okay, so as we were pretty much spoiling it earlier, we were talking that we got some new Saint Seiya Funkos announced.
I was actually surprised by those. I was not expecting
that. Me too! You know, again, going back to the whole, Saint Seiya is dead in the US, nobody cares. Boom! 4 new Funkos.
I am somebody that does not care for Funkos at all. I'm restraining for what I really think about them. I really don't like them. But hey, if they get people that like those things to take a look in the series and say, what is this about? Then I'm all for it. And any merchandise related to Saint Seiya, even if it's Funko, hey, like the more the merrier.
So because it's that you can't compare them to other types of figures and their designs, you know. You can't compare Funko to a Nendoroid per se and say, oh, which the Nendoroid is the better. It's comparing apples to oranges, you know. They're two different styles.
The best way I can, the best way I can describe a Funko Pop is like they're the gimmick cup at McDonald's that you pick up for like a movie that in the 90s. This is like your Jurassic Park cup that you get with like a meal. Well, it's like as like say like an Android or something more higher end that it's own thing. Like this is just like this is just a freaking it's just an overpriced like McDonald's toy.
But you know what? You know, at first I was a little bit surprised that okay, and we might as well say. So what we had announced is the remaining bronze in their respective gold armors that they inherit. If you know your Saint Seiya, you'll know that where all that comes from. Seiya has already been released. Maybe hopefully I don't know how available Seiya in the Sagittarius armors is.
On the aftermarket, I have seen Seiya go for if the base price is $10 for a regular figure, I've seen it go for like $30. So it's like it's getting up there in scarcity. So it is selling.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, scarce, but if selling is probably so. Hey, maybe they'll get a release. We don't know. But anyway, so we're getting Aquarius Hyoga. We're getting Virgo Shun, Libra Shiryu, and Leo Ikki. Oh, I actually remember that.
Yeah.
And the whole reason, you know, I tend to forget the last Shun and Ikki is because we only see them towards the very end of the series.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so obviously we haven't even seen the anime, the Hades anime in English. We're still sitting here and waiting.
Hmm. And there's a convention going on, you know. Now that then would have been a good time to announce something. Hint, hint. Bandai. I'm not Bandai toy. Come on. You could have said something. Mm-hmm. You could have said something about a dub, but you don't. Anyways, keep going.
Yeah, but anyway, we only see Shun and Ikki in the Zodiac armors all the way at the pretty much the very end of the Hades saga. So. If you haven't seen the anime, you know, beyond the classic, if you haven't seen Hades on Tubi, which I think is the only platform that's available right now for the US with subtitles, or you can watch it with the Spanish sub if, of course, you understand Spanish. But so otherwise, it is a bit of a spoiler, not a big spoiler, but if you're wondering why Ikki he gets the Leo armor,
Brigo, let's not talk about that. Let's just skip that part.
But it is based on their. I mean, I don't think so. I mean, it's just the data that they're just based on their birthdays.
Okay.
Because, like that. That's the whole reason why they inherit because they are. It's something you don't really think about it, but you know, like Hyoga is an you know what is an Aquarius too. Each of the bronze today, you know, they match an Aquarius. Zodiac sign. So really, that's why.
Like, I'll say, don't say this particular reason itself, but like you know, but if that's a good actually a very good reason to say.
Yeah, no, I mean honestly, yeah, that's the way I think. I'm like, okay, you know, it makes sense because you know it really, you know, matches their sign. I mean, it makes sense that they would inherit, you know, something related to their sign.
Mm-hmm.
As far as I know, we don't have like say, to my knowledge, that anyone say maybe like say. Like a Pisces saint that was born, you know, as a Taurus, for example. When you think about it, that'd be pretty weird.
Yeah.
Because, you know, characters, they all, it's just something they always say. Say all the characters, they at least have a birthday or something. So, you know, it just seems kind of strange, but that's why those two got those ones. But anyway, go on.
I was gonna say, like I said, I'm just surprised that like they're just releasing stuff this late into the series. I'm not saying like this late as in like oh like you know it's like very late as in like time wise, but like well time wise as in the series wise, not in like not right now, because like one like you said Hades is no one knows what's going on in Hades. The only thing if you only reference that I think people that would collect these things would be the manga.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And like the manga has been way out of print, and the only way you can get it is through digital or through like the Shonen Jump app. So it's so weird to see some of these figures, to see them make these figures. I'm happy because like I'm down for more Saint Seiya merch. I do collect somewhat these things, the Funko Pops. I'm not a huge, like, I have walls of them. I have, like, only characters I like. Only characters I like, and only get one. That's it. No more. No less. If not, I'm going to end up in that hole, and I don't want to end up in another hole right now.
No, which I mean, I only have Hyoga from the set.
Yeah.
My friend has all of them, though.
I
don't think she got Hyoga.
I got Seiya. That's all I really want. That's all I got Seiya. I wouldn't mind getting the Sagittarius cloth Seiya, but I got basic bronze Seiya. That's it. But then again, too, I'm staring at all the ones I got. Like, what, I just got Cobra Commander, Optimus Prime, Nezuko from Demon Slayer, Sergeant Slaughter, Cody Rhodes. Oh, mismatch of
people. Like I said, it really depends. Some of the phone, because I'm kind of like, but then some of them look really, they just really captured, like, I don't know, they just really captured the characters.
For yeah.
Sure, I mean, I have like a Retsuko Funko Pop.
Oh, yeah.
She looks great. Like,
yeah. I was gonna say, like, I got what's his face? Monokuma. I don't know if you guys play Danganronpa.
But I'm familiar with the guy. I know the crazy ass bear.
Yeah. They made one not too long ago, and the Funko Pop is like one of the few Funko Pops, like, they captured it perfectly. Because he already has like these weird beady eyes as is. So like it fits the character. It's like why not? But yeah, like, there's a market for these guys. These obviously sold really well, because I know I know like in the aftermarket these figures right now, like if I go through Amazon, like legit figures are going for like what, like $15, and usually the retail price is like $9-$10. So it's like, that's actually pretty good. That's actually put like investment over like time. So then like for example, The Ikki, the one that's with the blue, that one with the glow in the dark flames. I think that one and the Sagittarius class Seiya, those two are like in the are like $30 each, which is like rightfully so, because I believe Seiya was a like distributor exclusive, and I believe Ikki was a Barnes and Noble exclusive. That particular version.
I didn't know that.
So, but. That's really cool, and like and we were discussing before this, like, you already have the base for like five more gold saints. If you really want to go in and just like say, hey, we're gonna make Camus, we're gonna make Doko, we're gonna make Shaka, we're gonna make Iorios, there you go. You just need to like pop the heads and give new heads to these guys, and that's it.
So that's weird. As it seems like, why would they release the Bronze Saints again? Maybe it was kind of to sort of test the waters safely in a way, because it's still the Bronze Saints, you know. They're still the most popular, I think.
Yeah,
the better known. So you know, you're kind of giving you an out version. I'm like, if they sell well enough, maybe they'll go for the Gold Saints next.
That's what I'm thinking too, because like we know the Gold Saints will sell, because like those, like the gold, anything with the Gold Saint on it, we had the discussion before in the show. You put this gold saint on anything, people will buy it. any thoughts on all this, Benkos? I know you're not a big fan, but like just like briefly, if you have anything that you want to say before we move on.
Yeah, just emphasize again, like I might not be too fond of the Funko itself, but hey, if it gets more Saint Seiya related merchandise and that gets the hands of people that appreciate them and like them, then it's a good thing, regardless of what one may think of the Funko. So I'm happy for that.
All right, then let's move on to Crunchyroll. Crunchyroll just put up finally, oh my god, they finally put the subtitle version of Saint Seiya on Crunchyroll here in the United States. Is it also available in other parts of the world in subtitle as well? No. Oh shit!
No.
Let me check again.
But as far as I know, here in Mexico. We only have the dub.
The Spanish Latino dub is great. I'll give them that. But that still sucks. That does suck. Now we're kind of now in a huge advantage now that we have the subtitle version. Because there's always this huge discussion. Like, I'm not watching this show unless it's subtitled.
There it is.
Yeah. To be honest, and I'm probably in the minority here, I did watch maybe a couple episodes with the original Japanese audio. And for some reason, I couldn't get into it. I thought that they spoke way too fast. And maybe they did this back then, you know, in older. And now for newer series, of course, you know, say you slow their voices down. But it was something that a lot of people were requesting. So wouldn't you Crunchyroll for doing that? No, maybe give it to the other region.
Yeah, I just checked. It's in here, at least in Latin America, we only have the Latin dub and the Brazilian Portuguese dubs.
Ow. But at the same time, this is, like I said, like here in the United States, we're the whole dub versus sub thing is just I don't know why this. I don't know how. Like, I understand why this argument started, but like, people are still holding grudges to this day. Like, there are blood feuds going on for sub versus dubbed, and it's like when they first came out on Crunchyroll. Well, we were all very elated because like we all really liked the dub, and just to be fair, I love the dub as well. I saw people were like, no sub, no, don't watch it. I'm like, God damn it. So now it's I'm like, look, there's absolutely zero excuses on your end to like not watch the series. It's right there. You're already paying the subscription already for other series. Please watch it. I know it's just kind of a brief subject, but like, do you have, I guess, any other thoughts on this bit of news? Thank us.
First I was kind of shocked because I didn't know that they did that until you just told me. Yeah, earlier ago.
What? And, I thought that's where I posted.
I didn't know. I swear I didn't know. Like I haven't been on social media too much recently.
Oh, thank God.
I didn't see like the people where I normally get the information from, because I usually like learn about the news even if I'm not on it through other mediums. And nobody's talking about this. So like I'm legit surprised about this. And
probably because it wasn't in the Spanish Latin America, unfortunately, man.
Yeah. It's amazing, like it's astounding. Like I know that the new dub is also great, but if it's a thing where people will use it as an excuse not to check something out, if it's in Japan, if it has the original language with subtitles, hey, the better, right? Like the more options, the better. So this makes me very happy, actually.
Jackie, do you have any thoughts on this bit of news?
Well, you said, you know, for those of you that you know are like, subs are better than dubs. No excuse. Now go watch it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And also, people in the US definitely still like Saint Seiya. Sorry, I know this is going to be kind of a random insert thing, but it's just someone's share a picture for me from Anime Expo. Somebody is cosplaying over there as Sayori and Kamu.
This is not the time. This is not the time.
Sorry. No, that's all. But I just want to say, you know, there is Saint Seiya love in the U.S.
Yeah, there is, and I'm happy too. It's like, you know, we're getting more options. Things are opening up to the American market. Yeah, and I do hope that,
you know, that's the whole of it. That things are opening up. So, you know, I think every little bit counts. You know that. You know, no excuses. You can now watch it in Japanese. You know, read the subtitles. But maybe check out at least one episode in English.
Yeah, it's not bad. As a matter of fact, I have some thoughts about the dub when we get to it, but it's so like the stuff that's out there, especially in like the Gold Saints arc was really good in my opinion. So if you want to check out something from that part of the series. Any final thoughts before we move on to our next topic? Anyone? No one?
No, good.
Okay.
No, let's move on to the next one.
All right.
Let's go.
That's all the news we got. Unless there's anything else that anybody wants to bring up before we head on to our next topic. Because, like, we already hit up all everything else. Because, like, I'm not sure if I'm missing anything. No? Yes?
No. Just a quick mention that volumes 8 and 9 of the final edition came out in Japan in June. Okay. So, but outside of that, there hasn't like been any announcement for the following ones. Hopefully, we get them this year. But if not, hopefully early next year.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll have to wait and see.
Also, too, I forgot to put this on the slide as well. But because we have absolutely no info about this just yet. And this is more for Bankos. This is more for Bankos. Apparently, Toei is gonna start doing a collab with OXO. And one of the first things they're gonna be putting out in OXO stores is gonna be Saint Seiya merchandise. Exclusive to the
yes, apparently that got confirmed. I don't like credible sources cited this, and that like that's a plan that they intend to do. I haven't retweeted anything, or I haven't said anything, or I didn't put it here because I haven't been able to get like an official confirmation or something that kind of like let us see what it's actually going to be about. But it is apparently confirmed that here in, well, in Latin America, but specifically here in Mexico now, the convenience store chain OXXO, which is the biggest and the only Mexican one here in the country, but there are more OXXOs than there are dogs on the streets. So,
yeah, pretty much. You can't hit a ball while hitting like 50 OXXOs on the way up there.
Basically, every corner that you take here in this country, there's an OXXO somewhere around there. So, anyways, when we get the specific details, we'll be sure letting you know exactly what confirms what it's supposed to be about. But yeah, apparently, like in their intent of promoting their franchises, toy animation in general, all of them, obviously One Piece, Dragon Ball, etc., they are going to be doing stuff in this territory, which they have for a very big part been left untouched this past, all this time. And Saint Seiya was mentioned amongst being like one of the ones they're going to be pushing, and there's this collaboration confirmed with this convenience store chain, but we still haven't gotten the details as to exactly what it entails, unfortunately, as far as I'm aware, at least.
So Ben, has any color like then has this like this has been done before? I mean, with any other toy franchise?
Not that comes to mind, really. Not on convenience stores.
Well, they did a lot of stuff back in the days with Lawson's in Japan.
Japan, but like that, like outside of Japan, is practically unheard of.
I'm pretty sure too that they must have done like that back in the all or nothing days of the back when it was first started. I'm pretty sure they had something that we must have forgotten or something like that. I know they do stupid stuff here in the United States all the time too. Like they'll have like, here's a cup. You go to 7-Eleven, buy this Slurping, buy this cup. But matter of fact, they're doing this really cool promotion right now with Pac-Man. I'm like, oh god, I want some of that stuff from Pac-Man. I'm a huge fan of it. But that's a Saturday Morning Squad topic, not a Saint Seiya Cosmocast topic. But yeah, like if we get any news, like we'll be sure to say it. And like Benkos, please, like just as I'm gonna try to hook you up with the stuff for like Time Odyssey. Please try to get me some of this stuff. I
you
beg
got
of you.
It, don't worry about
like,
it.
Like I'm begging you. I want all the collectible mugs. I want all that super bullshit.
That's why I asked him. I'm like, if this had been done before, like what kind of merchandise that would you have?
I'm pretty sure it's gonna be a typical like, hey, here's a collectible cup. Here is a sticker album. You know, you buy a certain amount of things here for like you buy a
sticker
certain.
Sticker albums are pretty popular in Latin America still, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, they still do that.
Yeah, I mean, or you know, unless you're like unless it's the World Cup time, like everybody starts collecting them. Like you and me, I'm like, oh shit, like I gotta get all of them. Anyways, that's just me. But like
Yeah, I get it. It's just speculations, but some we don't. So this has never really been done before. So really, we're kind of just.
Yes, I mean the thing is, like, it's been done. It has been done with Saint Seiya. So we have a clear idea what they're gonna be doing. Like, if we see other places, like, I'm pretty sure we're gonna get some sort of like gimmick cup, or I'm pretty sure they're gonna have like some sort of like, gimmick flavor of whatever thing they sell. Like, you know. Icky, fiery red, like Cheetos or something like that. I don't know. Oh, God, that'd be great. Full disclosure. Why am I saying full disclosure? So just to let everybody know, I think Bangkok knows this more as well. Back in the days, back in those old All or Nothing days in like 94, 95, they used to sell Saint Seiya potato chips.
Yeah, they probably did. I think they did. It did. It's been such a long
time. Exactly. It's like, I remember this clear as day, man. Oh my god. But yeah. I wouldn't be surprised. Here's like fiery chip. Fiery potato.
You know, maybe the pogs.
Yeah, they released potato chips.
Okay, that's cool though. No, because in Chile, they didn't have the like actual like potato chips, you know, theme where, you know. Say, but they have like the it came with a pog. Actually, still have one from when I visited.
Oh god, I like my kingdom for those pogs, man. That's all I gotta say. Yeah. My Kingdom Falls.
Now they release it, but the one I have is actually from one of the packages. I was like, oh man, that was nostalgic.
Let me see. Okay, I found a picture right here. I'm gonna put it right here on our little Discord here. But like, yeah, these were like real potato chips, and they were like.
Oh my god.
Oh yeah.
Okay, you need to share that later on social media. That is.
I got a better idea. Like, I don't like doing this because like I usually have these things like a little bit more. I usually have a little bit more control. But like for those of you who are watching right now the stream, here on twitch.tv/lramses84. Let me show you what I just posted onto the...
Man, for packaging for the 90s, that looks pretty damn good.
Let's see. Damn. And we're just going to cover us for a little bit. Yeah, these are the potato chips. These are real potato chips that you could have brought in 1995. So, yeah. I remember this really well. Anyways. Yeah, I can't wait to see I can't wait to see any of that kind of stuff that's gonna come out next with Saint Seiya. It's always
good. Maybe they'll do those sodas. God, I've been seeing them a lot lately, like a lot of the character sodas for Sailor Moon, I've seen for Dragon Ball Z, and I've seen other series too, so who knows?
Yeah. Alrighty then. I guess we should go on to our next bit of discussion here about the English versions of Saint Seiya. Like I said before, I think I discussed this not briefly, but I had an episode about this way back when I was doing this solo. And I asked on Twitter if like anybody was interested in, like a lot of people were very interested on the topic itself. So yeah, I mean what's interesting is that when I did this like 3 years ago, we actually had no idea on a lot of stuff. But now we have a very clear idea on so many things nowadays, especially on stuff that we had no idea that what they were doing like behind the scenes as well. Like we have before I didn't even know about Star Storm, I didn't know about Guardians of the Cosmos. We know that stuff now, so that's really cool. That's like that time has let us like get like a kind of an update on what's on all this. So obviously, of course, if you're not familiar with Saint Seiya. Saint Seiya started in 1986 in Japan, both the manga and the anime. I believe the manga started first, and then the anime soon after. And I believe in like early 1990, 1991, we started seeing it in like other places around the world, like in France. And then around like 92-ish, 90, around 94-ish, it came to Mexico. And that's why I think like that's when the biggest kind of like response to Saint Seiya started happening. Like that's when I think people started taking notice about the series. When it finally started hitting Mexico, I think like once people's ears started getting to the ground about that, that's when people started paying a little bit more attention to it. However, we do know for a fact from various documentaries that have been released over the last couple of months that there were attempts as early as 1992 to bring Saint Seiya here to the United States. The first one. Was first one that we know of, well known at this point, was Guardians of the Cosmos, and oh boy, we discussed that last episode. Like I said, I love it for all the wrong reasons. however, I think like this is kind of a weird one because I'm not 100% sure how this was distributed. Yeah, how was it distributed? There was a dub made in English. That was, I'm pretty sure, made internally at Toei. And it was just like a compilation like things that they would show. And it's just like one that's kind of floating on the internet is a time when Seiya had to save Sayori from the crow guy. What was the name of that guy?
From Jamien?
Yeah, Jamien. Yeah. Jamien, yes.
Jamien.
Yeah. So they had a level of that, and like I'm pretty sure they got like, okay, who can speak English here in the house? Who can speak English here in the office? Okay, you, go in. We're dubbing this, and I'm pretty sure what the intent was. Cause I know they do this a lot of times for like flights, especially like long flights to like from Japan from like you know for either the United States or from like other parts of the world that's a little bit too far. So for like international flights, I'm pretty sure what they did was they had a dub made, and you can like watch it on like on the video on demand, like, you know, on the services, like, you know, you just like you pop, they give you an option like, hey, you can watch this, and like you watch the pop in the video, it's like, oh, it's a cartoon. We're a cartoon dubbed in, like, you know, as an in-flight thing that you watch, like, on your little on, you know, on the way to like Japan. So I'm pretty sure that's what it is, but I'm also under the assumption too, this was an early attempt at a dub that they were trying to do, and it was something that, like, they were trying to sell they were using this as like a selling thing to like sell to like distributors and say, this is Saint Seiya, this is what it is. Here's a basic thing, you know, here's a basic primer of the series. Would you want to license the series out, and you know, you guys can make a proper dub? I'm pretty sure that's what that dub was. But I don't know. We don't know about that. We do know for a fact that particular dub was available on the Laserdisc versions of the series. And recently someone has been uploading it with the new remasters that have been going around with since the Netflix release. So you can actually see a lot of that. You can see that dub, how it's supposed to be with, like, you know, with modern HD visuals. So that's really cool. And like I said before, after that we got Guardians of the Cosmos. Somewhere in between, either between 92 and 96, we have absolutely no real idea when, because, like, again, we have no real confirmation just yet. But somewhere between 92 and 96. There was another attempt at bringing Saint Seiya as a hybrid, as a live action TV show. Even then, I'm still dubious to the fact that I'm pretty sure this is going to be a hybrid show, like how they were proposing to do Sailor Moon as well as a hybrid, like, animation and like and live action show. But I am not like 100% certain until like more information comes out about this. We interviewed someone about this, and they too are just as confused, and they're just as bewildered as, like, what's going on as well. So it's like we absolutely have no idea what that series was going to be entitled to. The only thing we know is we have footage. We have like about 10 seconds of footage, and that's it. And that's footage for Starstorm, and that's all we got. That's all she said. I don't know what else we can talk about. I don't know what else can be said, like, you know, or discuss about that other than, like, it's there. So far, you guys have any questions? Anything I brought up that I've been missing?
Just, it's more of a matter of speculation when you try to think about those attempts. Like, I know that there exists an interview with the guy that, not Saban, but that was like in that company that wanted to bring it originally.
Yeah.
And like the process, like he explained kind of like the thinking of or the mindset behind the way that they were trying to handle it, which in a way makes sense business-wise, but those types of business-type decisions that maybe in the business sense they make sense, but when you look at the product that you're trying to bring, it makes absolutely no sense. It would be more about trying to just speculate as to what... for me, it all comes down to one question. What the hell were they thinking with some of this stuff? It's like... But on the other hand, like, it would have been very interesting if maybe some of them had actually gone through, right? Like, what would have happened if Guardians of the Cosmos got an entire season, or maybe two? Who knows?
And here's the funny part: if Guardians of the Cosmos had come out, it would have been 92, at the earliest, or 93 at the earliest. Saint Seiya, when it first aired, was in 94. Imagine watching two different versions of Saint Seiya at the same time.
Would have been so weird, man. Like, that
yeah.
would have been
because, like, you
that, because if there had been like if the American cartoon had actually been made, it would have made its way here. That's for sure. Eventually, yeah. Maybe not necessarily before the original anime, but it would have made its way here for sure. So it would have been very strange. Very strange. I don't know how that would have played off.
But yeah, I'm pretty sure too. Like I'm pretty sure that a lot of that mentality about, like, oh, like, why are you making a hybrid, like, live action TV show and stuff like that? It's because if it was done in 94, 95, Power Rangers was just piping hot at the time. So they wanted to just strike all the irons hot with Power Rangers. That's it's all comes to razor at this point. Like, if Power Rangers was popular, that's what they were going for, and I'm pretty sure that was the original intent. Like, Power Rangers was popular, same with shows like Hercules, The Legendary Journey, Xena was popular, so let's try to do something that capitalized. So let's capitalize on the let's capitalize on Power Rangers and those Sam Raimi TV shows and just do something with that. So I'm pretty sure that was a mentality. Again, we won't know a lot about it until the air is cleared. Raymond had said that she's going to be coming back to that topic later, and I do believe she did say recently that she is going to come back to the topic of Renaissance Atlantic her next video. So we might be getting this stuff sooner rather than later. So obviously, of course, this leads us to 2020. This is 2003. Oh, this is 2023. This is this year. And Knights of the Zodiac, the very first attempt at dubbing a proper dub of Saint Seiya, quote unquote, was done here in the United States by Deke. And this was a rough one. I remember being excited because I was a huge fan of Saint Seiya. I was really excited for them for finally this series I loved so much when I was growing up in Mexico. Finally, people can see it in English, and I saw the first episode, and my face fell. I was like, oh my god! I started slipping into my seat, like, oh my god, this is really fucking happening, isn't it? Like, this is it. Like, this is where we are. This is real life, isn't it? This is it. The death sentence has already been sentenced. It's all downhill from here. And for those of you who don't know, like what they were trying to do was like they were trying to make a dub that was appealing to not just appealing to quote unquote kids, but they were also trying to do a dub that was kind of like playing up to the more to the standard of practice at the time as well. I'm pretty sure this is what ended up happening. They had a dub. They did this dub completely for an intent to bring this to not to cable television, but the original intent was to be for like broadcast television, which was still big at the time. Nowadays, who the hell watches like regular TV unless you're watching sports? But at the time, like, you know, you would use ABC, CBS, you know, NBC, Fox, UPN, WB, they were still airing stuff constantly. And I'm pretty sure their intent at the time was to air on one of those networks. And what must have happened was no one was taking the bait. So what ended up happening is that they kind of went to the Cartoon Network, and I'm pretty sure they were under the impression that this show was going to be something that would air like during the day, during time hours that they would air the show. Like, not on regular rotation, so they can, like, kind of, like, get away with a lot of the type of stuff. But they kind of did a huge mistake, and they kind of did, like, the biggest mistake, in my opinion, like, even bigger mistake, in my opinion, that they did, was they didn't put it in their flagship show, their flagship anime show. They didn't put it on Toonami. That was, I think, like, the first big, huge problem, in my opinion, that, like, you didn't roll the red carpet for this, you did not put it on Toonami. Second of all, was the fact is like they put it on a 7 o'clock time slot on Saturday nights. No one's fucking watching television at Saturday nights at 7 o'clock. No one is.
I was.
Yeah, but I here's the funny thing. Like, do you want to know what the show came on after this? He-Man the Masters of the Universe, that 2000...
Oh, you know, was it when it was airing? Okay.
I was watching. I love that cartoon. I will defend that cartoon to death. I love that 2000s He-Man and Masters of the Universe. That is the greatest cartoon ever made. It's like top 10 in my opinion. And I was watching it because like that show was freaking awesome. And I had to endure watching this to get to that. That was originally like, oh, I get to watch two great cartoons that say, how long until He-Man starts having it? Oh, fuck me. So, like, I mean, and like I said, also too, like, they were going by a lot of weird sensibilities at the time of, like, of dubbing, dubbing wasn't really as done more seriously as it is now. Nowadays, dubs are, like, you know, they're taken really seriously, and a lot of dub actors are just fantastic people, like, overall, and they do an incredible job, especially with the current dub that you're doing with Saint Seiya. But at the time, like, they got a couple of people from Canada, and they said, hey, just dub this over. Bada bing, bada boom, let's go. Let's bring this out. What I like to call this dub a dub that was the wrong dub at the wrong time. If this was dub was done in 95, 96-ish, around the time that Deke Sailor Moon dub was also on, I think there would have been a warmer reception to this series, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Because it has a lot of weird Sailor Moon like dubisms, but it's 2003. You shouldn't be like there were other dubs.
We're starting to shift to the better dubs. When did the Dragon Ball Z dub be picked up? Was
like up
1996.
99.
99 was it?
Yeah, 99 was when they started when Funimation finally started dubbing like the stuff afterwards when it was on TV. Yeah. That's that like around 99-ish, 98, 99. That's when they started dubbing all that stuff, and like yeah, that's when it started.
Yeah,
like there was some weirdness because like they had to change the music, of course, because at the time that like there was a whole issue. I was like, no. This sounds a little bit too close to like another song. Let's get some butt rock up in here. So it still has stuff like that. But what I'm saying is there's another show that was airing at the same time and that same kind of block that they were giving, and that was Naruto. And Naruto, say what you will about Naruto, But at least I'll give them this much when it comes to Naruto, especially when they were airing it at the time. They at least put some sort of respect to it. The edits were not at like they obviously yeah they had to edit a lot. They had to edit a lot, but not to the point where it was to its detriment. Like there's still like stuff like okay, they can't show that much blood, stuff like that. Fine, they can't show a lot of like leechiest things. Fine, but overall they kind of played it straight and they kind of played it up to the strengths of its characters a lot more. Here. They're missing every pitch that's coming right at them. That's I think the biggest misstep is like they're trying to do something. They want to do something with this dub to make it more palatable with like and more likable characters. But you have an example of an anime right now that's airing about an hour or two later that's more traditional in its terms of its dub. And it's taking advantage of the fact that it's taking advantage that it's as centered as it can get. Here they just kind of like took whatever script that he got and just whatever. Let's just put it out there. Any thoughts so far, Benkos?
It's just that I was actually trying to think a little bit about because okay, it definitely was a huge problem. But because I was thinking back then, right? The problem that many anime series had when coming to the US, that they had to be modified because many of the things did not go well with the American audience. And I was trying to think, like, how could have gotten away with leaving the show as it was, like the way that it came to Mexico, which was basically untouched. And to be able to show it in its original form, but truth be told, I couldn't think of like any proper way of doing that back then. Like thinking about the mid '90s. So I suppose that like hearing you speak and talk about that, I think that definitely would have been the best solution. Like either put it on Toonami on a later schedule that could allow the original show to be shown without censorship, or not modify it to the extent that they did, because it was modified to just such a ludicrous extreme that it's baffling. It's baffling what turned out from it, right?
Go on.
I was just gonna say, so that's just what I was thinking. Is like, what could have been, but unfortunately, it's not what happened. And well, it's just what it is. It's unfortunately, it is what it is, right? So
yeah. I wonder if it just kind of got caught in that trend. I mean, it's hard to say. Transitional period where in America we really were shifting from, like, people started demanding because of the internet, and you know, people finding out, oh, this got so censored, people were starting to demand, no, we want the original stuff or less censorship, either put it in a different time slot. You know, we're in that transitional period that a lot of these shows were landing on the Saturday morning blocks that we still had in the early 2000s.
And it doesn't help too. It doesn't help too. A lot of it at the time too. We had Adult Swim. And at the time too, they had split the block in half at the time, because like this was when they had the series, when they had Adult Swim on Saturday and Sunday nights, mm-hmm. and the Saturday block would be the anime block, and on Sunday would be like the comedy shit, like, you know, your Taco Teen Hunger Force, and while there was still a lot of censorship on those on that Saturday and the Saturday night stuff, they were able to get away with a lot more in that time slot.
That's so weird, because I think there was the issue that I remember Toonami had, like, you know, the usual the afternoon and they had that nighttime block.
Well,
they would show that supposedly more uncensored, and then they went into Adult Swim. It was kind of like really like I don't know if they had like eventually their Saturday block went from their like the you know the more east. Years of then the maybe the last issue were the ones that were kind of more like that Toonami late night before I actually went to Adult Swim.
I think this all comes back to the fact that the person, like, it all comes back to Deke. That's my biggest issue. It all comes back to Deke, and I'm gonna.
Yeah, they got the rights,
and they got they're the wrong company to they were the right wrong company to do this, and they went about this all wrong. Like I said, if this was 1995, 96, I would have been fine with it. It would have been something like, "Oh, hello, well, like they made it dumb," but we have already, like, Toonami was like this huge monolith everywhere around the world. As a matter of fact, when around the same time that Saint Seiya started airing in, like, you know, here in the United States, other Cartoon Network affiliates around the world were starting to air Saint Seiya, and they were rolling the red carpet. They gave it like the premium like Toonami treatment, and it helped them so much.
Oh, I did not know that. Wow. That really got the crappy end of the stick.
Yeah, that's the saddest part. Like, when I remember watching, like, because, like, at the time I had satellite from Mexico that I can watch from, mm-hmm. like, from the United States. And I would, like, watch. And I would watch, like, the Saint. I'd be watching Saint Seiya again. And I'm like, oh my god. Like, what is this? Like, what is, like, Why are we getting these leftovers? Why are we getting like the sloppy seconds here? Like like Mexico's treating this like all sort of respect that you will not believe, and they're letting this show to die here. And yeah, I mean, like I said, like this was not a good dub, and like, you know, I'll post a couple examples of it on the links later. But overall, like I said, this dub was just not good at all. It's not to say, however, that there was not some good that came out of all this. One, we did get the manga. We did get the manga that
we did get the manga, yeah.
And like, you know, the problem with the manga is like they were adhered to a lot of the weird naming conventions in the for that Deke dub. So we have times where, like, we have characters like Death Mask, where they can't call a guy Death Mask, so you gotta call him Mephisto. And because no people don't know what a fuck a Cygnus is, because people are stupid, they had to call Hyoga Swan, and I'm like, so at least
in Spanish they do use the word Swan for him, Cisne, rather than Cygnus.
Yeah, but at the same time,
I know, it sounds weird. In English, it sounds weird. It doesn't sound as fancy for some reason.
Yeah, because like the Cygnus has like some sort, has like a regalness. Swan is like that. It's those damn ducks at the park that try to steal your hot dog.
We go from poor Hyoga to that.
You're giving me an idea for a drawing.
Any artist in the house, please do that. Just make okay. Hyoga. Just make fertile Hyoga trying to take up someone's
hot dog.
Yeah, trying to take someone's hot dog. Yeah, we got the manga, and like I said, other than those weird name changes, a lot of it was intact. A lot of, like, I know we were discussing the manga not too long ago, I believe like a couple episodes ago, and you were saying like a lot of the weird changes of the manga were kind of took you by surprise, didn't it?
Yeah, because the when here's the thing, like, I only, obviously, the first introduction to the series is usually, not just for this series, but it usually tends to be the anime, right? Like,
yeah.
Unless you are very much, like, nowadays you can make the argument, you can make another argument, but back then there was no two ways around it. Like, there wasn't a manga industry worldwide. We just got the animations because as far as distributors probably were concerned, they were just cartoons, right? Like, they didn't differentiate. So that's the way that you got exposed to Japanese franchises. You watch the anime, and then if you liked it, if you were interested enough, maybe later you would like. Okay, my history was like, I didn't know that manga existed until 2000 something, when precisely, say, Saint Seiya and other franchises that I was liking, I learned that they were based on comic books, and I learned that they were starting to being distributed here. That's what got me into that. But the entryway always is the anime, and for me, when I discovered the manga, because I expected it just to be like the frames, like that's what was on my mind. Like, for example, because I had read American comic books, so my mind thought, okay, it's probably going to be the same thing that I watched as a kid, or it's going to be the same thing as the cartoon, because I didn't know the terms back then, and it's just going to be the frame on paper. And to a degree, it was. But when I started to see all the differences, both in storytelling, in execution, and some of the things that were censored heavily, well, there weren't that many, but Nachi, I will never.
That's perfect. That was the point I was going to get at. In the American version, they left that in the American version of the manga, and that too threw me off. I was like, oh my god, they let this go in something that's labeled for kids. And I was really happy about that. That's why I was like, don't sleep on the manga. Don't sleep on the manga just because they have to use the translated names. They got away with a lot of stuff. And like I said, that's right there in the Shonen Jump app. Just pay $3 a month.
For some reason, they always get away with a lot more.
Yeah.
Whoever is listening, I highly, like, okay, speaking only for myself, but I highly encourage anybody that likes this series to read the original manga. You trust me when I say that you may still prefer the anime, and I'm fine with that, but you will really appreciate the series in a different light if you read the manga.
Yeah, I will say that. And but like I said, like they got away with a lot, and I do really appreciate it that they got away with a lot in the manga. So if you're looking for something that's as close as possible to an uncut view at the time of 2003, your manga was the best bet. We did get the DVDs, but the DVD market, well, there was two huge problems with the DVDs. One, the DVD market is not as it is today. And the problem is that the DVD market now is focused on giving you box sets, and they give you like all these things to like watch and binge. Where at the time it was like very much like you get four episodes for like $30, you know, vaya con Dios. And like
that hurt back then.
So getting a full collection of Saint Seiya like DVDs was very costly, and it got even more costly because a lot of it was, a lot of companies mandated, especially Japanese companies, they mandated a higher price for a lot of DVD releases. Like, they were afraid of reverse imports. They're really afraid of reverse importing. So the compromise between the companies would be to make a higher, when we make these DVDs at a higher price range, or kneecap how many episodes there are on each DVD. And I think ADV went with ADV and Deke went with went the route of putting less episodes for an inflated price, which I think really was not a good idea, in my opinion, because like that was something that like that caused a lot of that. That making each DVD $25-$30 each was pretty bad, especially like, okay, $25-$30 now is not bad, but you gotta look at it from like 2003, which is insane to think. It's insane thing to say now, but you gotta take inflation into consideration. So if we were to take consideration of inflation 20 years ago. But $30. Let's be very generous, because like you go to a Sam Goody's, or you go to like a, or you go to a Suncoast, you know, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. That don't exist anymore.
I was gonna say Jackie's having flashbacks right now.
I am.
So you walk into a Suncoast or you walk into a Sam Goody's, and you see a DVD for like $30. Fine, because like that's how they would price their animes at the time.
Yes, I know.
So imagine walking to like Walmart now and find that same DVD, and it would be four episodes for like $60. That's how bad the inflation is. So it's like you're paying almost double, if not a little bit more than double, when it's all said and done. And that's why that idea kind of didn't work. And also, like too, like another thing that was being very prevalent at the time was piracy. Like more and more Vatican was starting to become more available in the United States. There was a lot more places starting to open up. Simultaneous like a fan search was starting to be the standard now. If there's any anime you had anything you had that you wanted to check out, it was right at your fingertips. It was the Wild West at the time. Like there was some issues, but not a whole lot. But if you really wanted to get Saint Seiya, you could find some sort of fan server and they could have done it. Or you know, you can get the latest episode of Bleach out like about an hour after it aired in Japan. It's up to you.
Yeah, because people were starting to upload the stuff in torrents, so
it's like for that's how like me, so it's like, you know, I mean that was for me. I was like, you know, I could get Saint Seiya. Or I could get Bleach! Holy crap, Bleach! And all that, it's free! No one can stop me! I was a stupid kid back then. But
we all were.
But like I said, like and also another thing that was also muddling a lot of what was happening was, and this is something that no one get that just doesn't get really talked about. I think we talked about this briefly, is that ADV was hitting a saturation point. And it was because of the fact that like they had to distribute a lot of stuff that's considered trash. Because I'm pretty sure, like, okay, you want to get this series, but you have to also get, you also have to put up this series as well. Like this, it was a package deal. And unfortunately, because of a lot of stuff was a package deal, they had no choice but to like oversaturate the market and put out the stuff that no one wanted. So you had ADV who's working with Deke, and they just made a dub that was just like what I would like to refer to as a Mick dub, just something they just put out there because they have other stuff out there, and I don't think that was their highest priority. I'm pretty sure this was something that Saint Seiya was something they got in as like a package deal, and then something else that they must have gotten from Toei was like their big ticket thing, and that's where more of their efforts went into. And this was something they're like, oh fine, we'll just take whatever. Either that, or because they were working with Deke at the time, and they were kind of like conjoined at the hip, they were like, okay fine, just get Deke out of our butts, we'll get our C team to like do this dub, whatever. But I'll just put it out there, whatever, fine. And that kind of hurt a lot of its potential. So that first dub, well, you know, I wouldn't say it's beloved. I remember watching it, and it's like I thought it was fine, but it was at a time too where I can clearly tell that like there was no effort put into this dub. And it became very evident when we were rewatching the series, and like before it went back to like Crunchyroll, and we had to look through the butthole of the internet to find like these episodes. I remember someone had uploaded an episode of that ADV dub, and the contrast is night and day. Like you can tell, they gave no shits whatsoever in the ADV dub. Well, this current dub by Sentai Filmworks, they're giving it all and then some, which is sad, but also at the same time too, it's like, oh man, it's like it's a stark contrast. And then with all those things in mind, the inflated prices, the amount of episodes on each DVD, the bad reputation of a bad dub that's already on TV, and also just a dub that people don't care about. It just didn't make Saint Seiya look appealing to people. And like I said, too, it's like you're like another thing that you need to take in mind is, like I said, 2000s, or like late 90s, 2000s, that early 2000s, that brief sliver of time, it was a gold mine. Like you couldn't, like that was a really big time for anime. And when you're competing with other stuff and you don't put your best effort in, like to present something in both television and in both like something you present on television and something you present on DVD, you're not doing any favors at all. And that's, I think, one of the biggest reasons why it failed. Like a lot of people like to cite the fact, like, oh, because there's two dubs. No, because I'm pretty sure, I'm pretty sure the anime audience had an idea what was going on. It's just, I think how they presented the show was not appealing to like an anime audience, and it was just too little, too late before they can course correct. That's my honest opinion about what happened. But you guys have any thoughts on Benka? Do you have any thoughts on all this?
Nothing. I think there's nothing that I could add to right now, because it's basically all the thoughts that I have currently in my head. It's just a speculation of what could have been, and maybe that would be like a good topic for us to discuss, like, or sometime, right? Like, imagine if, like, what would have happened if had it been different. But for now, I don't really have any more to add to the topic. I think we've said pretty much everything regarding like how it turned out and why.
Jackie, do you have any thoughts? Were you buying those DVDs at the time? Were you like aware of those DVDs?
No, I definitely remember seeing them. Granted, I didn't realize that there was a DA DVD dub that was completely different than the Dig dub. I thought it was just a Dig dub, but yeah, for me at the time it was like really hard to, like, you know, want to buy DVDs. I don't know. I don't think I had a DVD player even at the time. It was just too damn. I was too much of a broke college kid.
I think I was fortunate because I'd saved up for a PlayStation 2 a year before by doing my first job at Toys R Us. So I was like, yo, first thing I am buying a PS2 so I can watch movies and play CVS2 and Metal Gear Solid 2. No regrets. Yeah,
I remember why. When I got my first DVD player, that was a big deal. And then, man, I just only because I like Cardcaptor Sakura so much, I remember buying that DVD. $35 hurt, but then again, you know, when you were making only like what, barely 300 every 2 weeks, it's like, yeah.
Yeah, and also, it wasn't just ADV that was also like doing, that wasn't just ADV that was like overpricing their stuff. I believe that was Genion that was doing it before. That was Pioneer. Pioneer was like absolutely overpricing their shit. I remember like seeing their Sailor Moon stuff. It's like, what, they were like, they're on the same price, like $35 for each EV. Like, no, I'm not gonna pay that much. I would rather suffer watching the edited version on Toonami than buying these on DVD.
I mean, there's a reason why I was, even for Sailor Moon back when I was into it back then, I would just buy the movies that, you know, the censor ones.
Yeah.
The Walmart versus the whatever that we're selling you, the uncensored. I'm like, sorry, I'll take the more cut version because I can't stretch my pocket that much.
Mm-hmm. And that's another thing, too. It's like, you know, that's another thing that's interesting. Like, there was still a VHS market. Like, it's interesting that, like, there was no VHS release at the time, because like VHS were starting to be phased out slowly, but we were starting to see a lot of that stuff slowly. Like, this was like, I think, one of their big experiments to like go digital with go DVD only. I think that kind of also backfired on them as well, because it's like, oh, you're asking us to pay this much and for something that like there's not a big install base just yet. You're up. No.
Yeah, I know what's gonna. Yeah. Because it was kind of the face that a lot of the kids' stuff was still being released on VHS because, you know, there was kind of like, I guess, maybe cheaper to produce and versus back then, DVD, you know, like, oh, you took care of your DVDs for like pristine stuff. Like nowadays, it's like the DVD is more like the throwaway version you might take on a road trip, but you keep your Blu-ray at home, you know.
Or, you know, you just have a digital copy of the movie or something like
that. Or that, yeah. But you know where I'm going with that.
Yeah.
Just, that when they were... But it's
so
part of the history.
So here's a, here, so I'm saying, so after that, like, we had, like, no real Saints Day activity. It kind of went stagnant after a while. Some companies did pick up a lot of the series from time to time, but like the problem was the damage was done. The perception of Saint Seiya was kind of like damaged over because of that, and a lot of times a lot of companies don't want to take a risk with. They didn't want to take a risk, so you had companies that were releasing just the box set of the series, just subtitled, or they wouldn't even bother it. There was a time where Toei themselves had to like just push out the series subtitled on various like hole in the wall parts of the hole in the wall like places on the internet. I remember when Twitch TV first started popping up, and they had like this channel called Con TV, and they would sometimes play episodes of Saint Seiya subtitled. So that. There were times where Saint Seiya was just not like very visible, and if it was visible, it had to be like something like, oh, like we have it subtitled, but we also got like the Spanish version or something like that, and yeah, that was kind of like how it was for a very long time, like a lot of like hands off stuff. Discotech released the DVDs first, and then they released the Blu-rays of the movies again as a way for them to test if there was a market for Saint Seiya. But again, it's either you commit to doing the series or not. We've seen, it's not a huge seller for them. We've seen a lot of like the comments on social media with some of the personnel that have openly expressed like stress, like they're all that, like I wouldn't say they're the anger, like yeah, let's say anger, like they're just like they're very angry that like they didn't make those sales, and it makes me wonder, like, was it something that was mandated by Kurumada Pro, was it something mandated by the company, or was it something that like whatever was going on, because like that's,
you wonder, because unfortunately Japan, we know that even to this day they still, in you know, with new media they're trying to bring over to the US, sometimes they still make stupid mistakes. They're like, they don't know what the F they're doing.
Yeah,
simple as that.
Yeah, and that's
so what they think works in Japan, it's not gonna work over here necessarily.
And not just that, yeah, too.
And it's a case of, unfortunately, you know, the people that are in charge, well, the people currently holding the licenses in Japan are old, they are old-fashioned Japanese fellows. So unfortunately, they don't know what they're doing.
Oh, many suits. Yeah, we know. It happens a lot.
It's not just a Japanese thing. It's a like that's an everywhere thing. Anybody with money, they still have this backwards mentality.
Yeah.
But
yeah, unfortunately, they're stuck up there. So, well, it is what it is.
But there is hope in this story. There is a happy ending to all this.
Yes, there is.
So in 2019, we did get the first season of the CGI show, which we saw, and we have thoughts. Horrible beginning, really impressive middle, horrible end, but now it's getting streamed and it's actually really good. I'm really happy about that. That's at least it's now being consistently good, not fine, not the best, good. It's something I like. At least I'll watch on whenever it pops. So, but to accompany that, so obviously first they dubbed this particular version in English as well, and they took a lot of the same cast from that dub, and they also did a dub version of the anime. And throughout 2019 and 2020, we started getting the series on Netflix, and for the very first time, we finally got over that hump. Because like every time they used to release a series, it either was middle or just the sanctuary arc. But for the first time, we got all 114 episodes of the original series dubbed. And while it didn't last for too long, I think after 3 months after they put the final episodes on Netflix, it got pulled out. It did get rescued by Crunchyroll. like a couple of months ago.
That it lasted for a year because that's what I watched in late 2020.
Okay, so yeah. It's really good that like we have finally a place to watch the series, as it's incredible dub that he put so much effort in. Now there's a subtitle version, so again, no excuses. Another great thing is, again, the manga is, well, it's out of print. Digitally, it's still available. And if you got the Shonen Jump app, that's the best way to pick up the manga, in my opinion. Like, that's like, because you're not only paying $3 a month to read Saint Seiya, but you have an entire archive of different shows, different stuff that you may enjoy. If you're there for Saint Seiya, stay for Dragon Ball, stay for Yu Yu Hakusho, stay for Spy Family, stay for Chainsaw Man, stay for, Dino Daibouken, or whatever hot is, Bleach, Jujutsu Kaisen, whatever new hotness of Shonen Jump, stay for, like, you know, come for Saint Seiya, stay for all that stuff, you're only paying $3. That's how I look at it. Like, I pay $3 to have access to Saint Seiya, but also, like, oh, cool, I can go read Chainsaw Man, because Chainsaw Man is freaking awesome. And another great thing, too, when was this? Was this 2019 or was this 2020? Seven Seas Manga started releasing Saint Seiya Show in English. And we had
an 2018. Yes.
Oh, okay. I will eat crow on that. Put the crow in my mouth.
Yes.
But, but like I said, this that like 2018, we finally got to Saint Seiya Show, which was something I did not expect them to release.
I did not expect it either. I was mind blown.
I'm really happy that they put out that series, even though they said it's not their top seller. I do believe now that all this stuff has happened with the series, that the dub is now more readily available to watch. And also, too, we had a movie and stuff like that. I wanted to take another crack at it and see if they can make another printing of the stuff so it can get to a wider audience. And we had a movie. And it was like, you know, our, you know, your mileage may vary. I thought it was perfectly fine. I thought it was a perfectly fine three out of five movie. It's a good 2.5-3 star movie. It's not the greatest movie in the world, but it's definitely not that's definitely not Dragon Ball Evolution. The levels are horrible, where they kind of missed the mark. There was stuff that, right, again, we there's a whole entire like 2-hour review of us reviewing it. Like I said, it's a great homage to like 90s trash movies that you pick up at the video center with like Michael Dudikoff and like Down the Dragon Wilson. I'm pretty sure those guys would have been, like I said, like I made a joke on my letterbox. I said, if this movie was made in 94, when Saint Seiya was at its prime, Shokasugi would have been Seiya and Michael Dudikoff would have been Iki. I guarantee fucking T that would have been the cast of that movie if it was made in 1994. But yeah, I mean, there's so much thing, like, you know, and that's just the stuff that's available, like, you know, right here. Like that's the stuff that you can, like, you see visually and that through visual media. There are a lot of attempts at toys and stuff like that as well that we haven't even touched. Like when the series was airing, Knights of the Zodiac, the 2003 dub, they pushed that pushed that series out, like, you know, like it was no tomorrow, and, you know, within good reason.
Like, I'm not buying those toys because I do remember seeing it's like I said I'm gonna get it and then I let it pass and it's out.
So I used to work at Sears, and right next to Sears was a KB Toys. And I would see those Saint Seiya toys go for, like, I see you want to see a free fall of a price? Go look. I wish I would have had a smartphone. I would have taken photos of those prices, because it was like, oh, here's this big full toy of Iki that was like $35. Now you can get for like $9.99, and it was still not moving.
That was bad.
That was really bad.
Because I remember the toys themselves were actually really, like, they looked like they were really nicely done.
Yeah, they were at least nice to them because I think like they took that they had a lot of their Japanese staff working on it, and that yeah. And what I like is that they relabeled a lot of that stuff, and they kind of make a supplementary toy line to like a lower end, say like Mythcloth line to accompany the higher end Mythcloth line. So like, okay, cool. Like if you want just articulated figures, here's like the toy again, but smaller, whatever. Like it's like $10. Just take it, please. Like we have a whole bunch of these. Please, I'm begging you, please take these toys. And I'm pretty sure too, a lot of those toys that someone, I don't know who said it on Twitter. I don't know if it was other people, but someone said something to me that kind of like blew my mind. If we go back and look at the model sheets for Guardians of the Cosmos, a lot of people have noticed a lot of those figures have the proportions, like the reason why they look too buff, why they all look like they're on HR, like TRT, is because they're going off the models of the toys.
What was it, the vintage?
Yes. Model? Yes. Because if you see those,
I forgot who said it, but yeah, I remember I saw that a few times.
So I remember a lot of people were saying like they would see those proportions. They see a lot of the artwork that they took, and they're like, oh shit, this is just the vintage toys. So I'm pretty sure that's where they based a lot of stuff from Guardians of the Cosmos, was them basing it off those toys. So I'm pretty sure their intent, hell or high water, was to release the vintage toys here in the United States. I'm very sure that was like their intention at one point. But
I mean, a lot of the cartoons back then were made pretty much with the whole intention of, you know, pushing toy lines out.
Yeah.
More than the cartoon was very more like the big ass commercial to push out the toys. That those were the money makers.
I feel like I'm being attacked because like you're talking to a guy who likes Transformers.
Hey, no, I'm just saying that's fine. But hey, if you like the toys, it's fine. Nothing wrong with it. I mean, hey, I collect stuff too.
Yeah, it's like, you know, it's what I say. It's like, look, I don't know who said this. It was a YouTuber that said this. He said, okay, it's fine to consume the stuff, but don't be obsessed with it. I'm not obsessed with it. I love the stuff, but you also acknowledge who's like, you gotta take the bad with the good. If there's something problematic with something, you have to call it out. I'll call out Transformers when it's bad. I'm the first guy to say, yeah, those freaking movies just suck. Those first couple of movies suck. Bumblebee and Rise of the Beast? Good shit. But then again, this has become an unofficial episode of the Saturday Morning Squad. And I'm sorry, guys.
We always go as that. There is one little thing I wanted to add in.
Go on.
Since we were talking about, you know, that there is more Saint-Seiya stuff that was released for the out there, I think there at one point, I don't know if this may have come from, you know, from when we had the Dig Dove, or maybe this is something recent that I don't know. But I've seen some. Oh, sorry, I moved my mic. There was like rubber laser cut keychains for Saint-Seiya with the English logo.
Yeah, those were, I think, I believe those were like 2011 ish.
Oh, because
I remember someone gifting me this, and the person in the chat, I won't single them out, but let's just say it was one of my favorite gifts that I got. Because they also got me that, and they also got me a Tuxedo Mask plush, and I'm like, those are like my two favorite things.
From GE, right?
Yeah, from Great Eastern.
Great Eastern, something like that. Yeah, okay. I was wondering when those came out because they seemed so scorched, and I'm like, huh. I always, even, you know, before we got all of this, I was wondering why we had the ADV done with Saint Seiya, you know, or Knights of the Soil, but then we actually have an official English logo, or I guess because it's.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure.
Using an international logo.
I'm pretty sure Toei kind of like said, look, we need a promo to show internationally. We need to have something to show in English. They do that a lot of times too. If you look through the copyrights for a lot of their shows, they have an English version just in case for their logos. Yeah. I remember seeing a lot of stuff for Pretty Cure. I'm like, other than starting with like, you know, like not Tropical Cure, the one before Tropical Cure.
I have to watch all of them seriously.
Like the one before that, they had an English name for it.
Mm-hmm.
And but they have, but if you go to their archives, if you go to like their website, look at their corporate, they have the logos in English for all the series to that point. And I'm like, yeah, they have this stuff just in case. So I'm pretty sure they had some sort of ad company whip up a logo for them just in case that they get licensed in the United States, or they had get licensed in a region that speaks English. Also, one little note. I think one other note that I want to talk about just really quick before we move on, because like we're this topic has gone way too long, but like you know there's a lot of interesting things to discuss in this topic. There are plans to bring one of the PS2 games here to the United States. We know this for a fact because when the game was data mined, I believe for the European version of the game, right? I believe the first Saint Seiya fighting game, Saint Seiya The Sanctuary, not the one for PS3, but the one for PS2. When it was data mined, they found data of the English logo in the game. So there were plans at one point to put the game in English with that logo. So because of that, I'm very sure there were plans to like go beyond just putting out the toys, but also putting out a video game as well. And because it just flopped, they never capitalized on it ever again.
Yeah, but yeah, it got canned.
So yeah, so it's like it's there, and I'm pretty sure, like I said, it was data mined, and you know we absolutely have no idea what happened with it, but like it's there. So
yeah.
Does anybody have any other thoughts on all of this?
Just since you mentioned the games that, just to add to the stuff of the, you know, Saint Seiya, you know, in English meaning, there is of course that the PS4 game.
PS4.
We have it for Steam, and I'm forgetting the name, but yes, that is available Soldiers. In English. Yeah, and for it also, it's available for the US.
Unfortunately, if you're trying to look for the Steam version, it is delisted. That's the unfortunate thing. The unfortunate Steam. That's good. And what I love about that, what I love about that particular version of the game is that it has various dubs in the game, especially the Spanish dub. It has the Latino Spanish dub. It is unfortunately the last known dubbing role for Jesus Barrero, who played the original voice of Seiya.
Yeah, I read about that. I was like, it has the Spanish dub. I'm like, I want that.
So it was his very last role as Seiya. He did, so it's quite unfortunate that he passed away, but it's great that like that the world can finally see in some way, some form his dub in the game. And it's why that's why I'm a huge proponent of them re-releasing that game with the new English cast. Like just give us like all that stuff, because like it would be really cool to have that game again with the current English cast that we got right now.
I don't feel like Bandai is due to, like, they're due for making another Saint Seiya game for consoles.
They are, but at the same time too, but going back to the topic of video games, another thing that we forgot too is like mobile. there's so many mobile games on. There's so many English mobile games of Saint Seiya. It's not even funny.
There's currently none from Bandai. They closed their service on all of those.
Yeah. Yeah, and yeah, it's like, you know, we would I would absolutely love for them to take another shot at them making a proper game, but hey, what can I say? But like I said, we have a lot of mobile games in English, you know, that you can officially get. They're not from like Toei or from Bandai Namco, but
they're officially licensed though.
Yeah, officially, yeah, by Kurumada Pro. So like they have so instead of having like the designs of the anime, they all kind of skewed more towards the manga, which is fine. Mm-hmm. I love the manga designs, and like you know, I'm not complaining. But
yeah,
we are due for another like Bamco game for them. Hopefully, in the near future, we'll get something. Is there anything else?
We can just have a separate episode one that just cover like the game history. Just limited to English.
Okay. We have, and like I wouldn't mind another crack at that, like some other time. But the thing is, it's such a weird topic to talk about the video games of Saint Seiya, because the video games of Saint Seiya were the first couple of video games were reactionary. They were very, very reactionary to the games at the time. The first Saint Seiya game for the Famicom, shit for dollars. That was a response to both Dragon Quest and also. Also of Xanadu for PC 88. I am absolutely certain that was like their intent when they were making that game. It was like, okay, what are the two biggest games right now? Okay, Dragon Quest? Okay, cool. What about the other game? Xanadu? Okay, cool. Make a game exactly like that. And then they made the game again. This time they kind of refined mechanics for the second game. Third game, they're like, okay, fine, we'll just make a Dragon Quest clone. And they made that Game Boy game. And then nothing. And like, okay, what's popular right now? Dragon Ball? Fine. We'll make something in the Dragon Ball Budokai engine with Saint Seiya. Put it out. And that's like, okay, what sells well? Anime fighting, arena fighters? Fine. Let's make an arena fighter. Make an anime arena fighter? Let's just make that. And what the only odd game out is Saint Seiya Senki, Saint Seiya Battle Sanctuary for the PS3. Because it's more of a Devil May Cry-ish game, where it's like you actually get to like do stylish moves. I'm like, that's my jam, yo. That is my fucking jam, because I love Devil May Cry. If there's a game that you want me to play, like if you say, hey Ramses, we're locking you up for like 30 days with nothing but your Switch, and you only have one game you can play, give me Devil May Cry 3, baby. Let's go. Because I want to be stylish. I want to be as stylish and cool as Dante. Anyways, anybody have any final thoughts? Because like this is a really long-winded conversation, to be honest. But Becca, do you have any final thoughts?
It's just that it has such a huge history. Like, it's funny thing. Like, the series itself has a huge, long history. But thinking about it in very specific markets, like talking about the history of that, it's so much.
Yeah.
And I'm sure there's still quite a few things that we could probably, in another episode, go more into depth if. More into depth onto the different parts of those topics that we've already touched. So maybe we'll take another look at this eventually as well.
All right, Jackie, you have any final thoughts before we move on to our?
If you guys want us to go into like a specific anything we talked about, you know, within the history of Saint Seiya, you know, in the English market, you know, hit us up. And you know, we can cook up something.
Yeah, I mean, I asked on Twitter, people were really responsive, and like it was a really fun topic to talk about all this stuff, because it's like it's something that I have somewhat a lot of knowledge on, and me and Jackie we both kind of had firsthand experience on a lot of these things, and I can clarify a lot of things talking to a lot of people in the industry, talking a lot and seeing a lot of stuff from like industry insiders to give you guys a better idea of what's been going on, because like. We hear a lot of stuff like hearsay, and like what I'm saying is hearsay too. But like I can confirm a lot of things, or I can deconfirm a lot of things as well. So, yeah, why don't we move on to our next topic then? We got to talk about what's blitz through these episodes then. What's blitz through these episodes of episode 75, episode 73 through 77, 74 and 70 through 77 of Saint Seiya. We are finally at Asgard, you know, the land, like, you know, it's a really cool place. And yeah, so like, let's try to keep it briefish as possible. So, Becca, why don't you open us up with like the brief summary?
Okay. Summary of episode 74. After the fight, after the fight with the Gold Saints, after the 12 Temples arc, we begin a new story. We begin in a land where it's never specified where it is, but we're told that this is Asgard, the place of the people of the Norwegian god Odin, and her priestess, the one that looks after this land after Odin. It's praying for, like, she's kind of lamenting and giving us like a bit of a glimpse on the situation of Asgard. It's a place that it's in extremely harsh environment. It's extremely cold. Apparently they have never seen the light of day. They have never seen the green of the fields. So very difficult situation. And then a voice comes, like she's praying in front of the ocean, and a voice starts speaking to this priestess called Hilda, Polaris Hilda. And a promise of Asgard becoming the dominant force in the world. And whom is approaching her and who is making these very questionable demands. And then this entity, by force, decides to bestow upon her a golden ring. And after she is giving this golden ring, her personality changes, and she starts to enlist her own warriors, or the Norwegian warriors, the Asgard warriors, known as the God Warriors. Each one bestowed upon a type of armor called God Robe that is based on a piece of Norwegian mythology. She gathers these seven warriors, and then they begin their attack on Sanctuary. One of them, Misar Sith, attacks Taurus Aldebaran in Sanctuary and defeats him easily in just one fell swoop, proving that these fellows are as much of a menace as the Gold Saints, if not even more so. Then this warrior decides to attack Sayori directly in her mansion, but it's thwarted by the arrival of the protagonist, the five Bronze Saints. The warrior, seeing that he's at a disadvantage, decides to retire, but now, basically, with a new war upon them, they realize they have to travel to Asgard to figure out what's going on.
Ladies first, Jackie, what were your initial thoughts on the episode?
You know, I have a weird history with the Asgard saga, because when I first watched it, I kind of started maybe about 4 or 5 episodes in, just because I got sent the VHS TV recording. So it was later that I got to see the beginning. So I kind of love hate relationship with this saga. That said, still when it was new to me, it was exciting to see, oh, hey, you know, so now we get to find out what happened after, you know, after 12 Temples. Before the next saga. And I, of course, at the time, I didn't really know either what would come next. I thought it was kind of disappointing, though, that Aldebaran got defeated so easily. In fact, it kind of bothered me, because I felt that the Goldies are supposed to be pretty OP. And then here comes this guy, 1-3 defeats Aldebaran. Other than that, I kind of felt that the introduction to what the general idea of this saga might be seems to be kind of rushed, but nonetheless, it's a, you know, it's gonna be a new story, a new adventure, we're going to a cold place, let's see what happens, and hey, you know, we get to experience, you know, Norse mythology within the world of Greek mythology. So, new take. Let's see what's happened.
Benkos, do you have any thoughts on the episode?
Yeah. Well, just to say something. This saga has a lot of interesting trivia aspects to it. But if you would permit me, I would like to save those for the next episode that we make, since we've already made a very long episode. So, I'll leave those for the next one. As far as this episode is concerned, like, three things pop out to me immediately. One, the interesting aspect of introducing a completely new pantheon of deities into this universe that, as far as we were concerned until now, the only ones that we know for a fact existed were Greek gods or Greek mythology, Greek deities. And now they are basically just saying, hey, yeah, the Norwegian deities exist here as well. So that opens a whole can of worms in both good and bad ways, but we'll get into that. I think that conversation better left for the end of the arc. But it is interesting to see how they focus their attention from one particular deity pantheon to another one, entirely different, like literally in the blink of an eye, because if you look at this... from the previous episode to this one, it's a very strong whiplash, in my opinion. Okay, that's one thing. The other one is the animation. Obviously, you can just see that immediately that this was animated by Shin Guaraki.
I was a question I was asking. Was this a Shin Guaraki episode?
Yes, this is a Shin Guaraki episode. And it shows. The animation is absolutely fantastic and beautiful here. And that's the second one. So everything, like the action, the movement, the presentation, everything is just chef's kiss. And for me, the third aspect to it is, okay, while we may be familiar with many of the tunes that accompany the Asgard saga, Thinking about it more in the sense of this is the first time that we hear many of those compositions, many of those arrangements. Mind you, that this is also the very first episode to use the second opening for the series, Soul the Dream, which happens to be my personal favorite.
Yes, thank you.
I love Pegasus Fantasy to death, and it will I always love it to death. But I don't know why I just gravitate more towards Soul the Dream as a song.
Thank you.
So
yeah. Same.
So yeah, so hearing that for the first time is just like, oh yeah, and not only the opening and the ending as well. Blue Dream is just it's just a beautiful.
We stand Hironobu Kageyama in this podcast.
Blue Dream.
Sorry, guys. It's just like look, Pegasus Fantasy. All-time banger. It's a classic. But don't sleep on anything by Hironobu Kageyama from this era of Saint Seiya. That's all I gotta say right now. Keep going.
Okay. So hearing many of the compositions for this arc, like many of the first ones here, it gives it a very distinct flavor and it makes it feel different from everything. Even though it uses a couple of melodies we're already familiar with, it mostly does new ones. So it gives a very fresh sense to this particular introduction to this new arc, and I thought that was fantastic. I have a bit of a problem with this arc, but I would like to leave that until we finish watching all the episodes so I can maybe like go more into depth on that. I do agree a little bit with Jackie that so some things like are kind of like make noise with me, like trying to leave those already thoughts that I have on it aside. For example, seeing Aldebaran defeated I know that the intention is they need to make them seem like a very powerful threat, and having a Gold Saint be defeated by one of them, it's a very good way of establishing the level of threat that they are supposed to represent. But when you look at the overall, they don't make sense later, but there's something that just feels wrong about
this. Oh, yeah.
So I'll just say that for now. And also, I like that even though Sean still needs to be, even though Sean still doesn't come out in the best light in this episode, at the very least, I think this is the time that they've put the most effort into actually trying to make him look well when it's something that is written by them specifically.
Yeah.
And Sean, he actually looks pretty smug, which seems really unusual for him.
Yeah,
I love that. That's actually a gift that I have stored in my computer of smug Sean. So I love that animation. But yeah, overall, I think that as an introduction, it's a very strong episode. A couple of issues here and there, but it's a very strong introduction to this new arc.
Okay. There's a very good reason why earlier in the show I was saying that I was feeling really nostalgic for this arc. When I first started watching Saint Seiya, guess where I started? This is my very first episode I ever saw of Saint Seiya. So I started with the Asgard arc. So this particular episode has so much nostalgia, and I cannot, like, it has so much meaning to me. Because, like, this was, like, I remember where I was, when I was watching this again, I was taken back to when I first watched the series, when I was totally confused. I remember every scene vividly in the back of my brain. So while others may have some complaints, and there is obviously some complaints, because, like, there's some really obvious issues with this saga. It's this particular saga that got me into the Saint Seiya, and this is where I first became a fan, when I first started searching the series again after I watched this, and I started seeing that they were wearing these weird cloths that made no sense and more lower quality animation. I was like wondering, like, why does this guy have a weird, like, horse on his head, a big old horse instead of a tiny little horse on his head? Like, he has cool hair. Why is the red guy pink? And why this? Why that? So it was kind of confusing, but I started understanding, like, oh, this is like that. This like the, what they're airing like on at this time, and this time is very much different than this and that. And I was able to piece together the entire series. And, like, overall, this episode is basically buy our toys the episode. Like, it was basically, it was like, here's all the new toys for the season, boys. Have at it.
Funny you mentioned that, because I was actually, I was forgetting about this. I was thinking about it when I saw the episode and forgot to write on my notes. I understand why they did it. Okay, but point of interest, this is the first episode in which they introduced the B2 cloth.
Yes.
For all the main five protagonists. And this is the first time that they actually are manga accurate. Mm-hmm. Because they actually put the manga designs as they were into the animation. So this is like a visual change over for them as well. And it just so happens that, like, I was thinking about it, like, was it really necessary for all the five of them to arrive at the very end, even though three of them, well, two of them do absolutely nothing? Like, how convenient! And all I could think about was, Bandai, here you come the again, don't you?
I made the joke, what the fuck are you doing here, Ikki? Get the fuck out of here. Like, I love, he just appears like, I'm here, now I'm gone. Bye, where's my check?
It's what they do.
It's like, it's like, look, I can understand Ikki just suddenly appearing. I'm totally down with that, because that is his MO at this point. Whatever, his brother's in trouble, he'll appear. But he literally was, I'm here, oh wait, my brother can take care of this, bye.
You know, maybe it was the style back then. You just had to have a character show up because
this was just an episode just to show off the toys. I love this episode because of that now, because it's like, oh my god, they're just show off all the new toys, and I didn't even know that. So it's like, for me watching it as a kid, like, yeah, this is like my very first exposure to the series, and I'm watching a glorified toy commercial.
That's it. That's what he has.
But
glorified toy commercial.
But yeah, I mean, I love the clots. I love that, you know, Shingaraki was doing the animation. I guess that's what elevates this episode to being really good, is that this, when you actually acknowledge that this is a toy, like they're trying to sell you toys, it's not a bad episode. It's a great way to get you introduced to Asgard, even though we technically got introduced to Asgard, if you were paying attention. If you're at the time watching the movies and stuff like that, we know how Asgard is because they went to Asgard already, quote unquote. But
did that happen? Was that our imagination?
Yeah, was it? Because, like, we know we've been there. Like, it was a pretty good movie in my opinion. But like you know, but
Toy just likes Asgard. They like to reuse it a lot. And I think that's where I have a problem with, but we'll get into that some more time.
But yeah, it was a great episode, and like I said, it's elevated more by the fact that, like, you know, they have this A+ team working on it, and it's a great, and like I said, like, for someone that has no idea what Saint Seiya is, this is a perfect episode to, like, get yourself into, in my opinion. Any final thoughts?
Mine are just, it's a very good starting point for this new story that they are trying to tell, and a very interesting turn of events for how different it feels from the previous one, and in hindsight, like, a very interesting, like, it very interesting how Toei decided to approach doing a filler arc, and is for this episode specifically, the start is very strong.
Jackie, any final thoughts?
Nope. None so far.
All right. Let's go. Next episode.
All right. This following episode, episode 75, begins with Hyoga running with a girl. We don't know what is going on yet, but then apparently soldiers that happen to be from the palace where Hilda and the god warriors reside. I'll tell you what I was laughing in a bit. They're running away from them, and then we finally get introduced to this girl. Apparently she's the younger sister of Hilda, and she is trying to get in touch with Athena to ask her to help her sister, because obviously, as we mentioned previously, after the ring was put into her hand, her personality and her desire to start a war changed. It's something that she didn't want to do prior to that. And she know, and her sister know this, so she wants Athena to help her get her back to the way that she was, because she know that something is wrong. Hyoga runs into a bunch of soldiers. He defeats them very easily. They make aware, the god warriors and Hilda, that apparently she's with a knight of Athena, saint of Athena, and then they decide to go after her. Hyoga and Freya. I forgot the name. I was like, is it Freya? Okay, yes it is. Thank you very much. Freya arrived with them. She explains her plight. Athena agrees to help. The other Bronze Saints are there as well. They all think that there's something fishy. All of them except Ishiki and Shiryu. Yeah. Shiryu went to ask. I forgot to mention on the previous episode. At the end, Shiryu mentions he'll go to Lucian to ask Doko. Like if he knows something about Asgard, and Ikki just decided to go fuck off because that's what he does apparently.
That's my shows are on. I don't be bothered.
Yeah, no explanation given. Anyway, so only Seiya, Shun, and Hyoga are there, and when the God Warriors arrive in a very menacing entrance.
Oh yes,
that is very very impactful. And then they kind of exchange words. They realize like what's going on. Hilda explains that her plan to start destroying the rest of the planet is by allowing the polar ice caps to melt and therefore flood the world, because apparently she kept that at bay by praying every single day and she hasn't been doing that. So Athena's role here becomes to try to use her power to stop that from happening. While the other saints realize that the thing that it's changed with her was what, because when she arrives, Saori notices the ring and she recognizes it as the, what's the name for it in English?
Nibelungen ring.
Okay, Nibelungen ring. In Spanish is Nibelungo. So I was like, how the hell did they say that in English? Okay, after she received that ring, that's when things
changed.
Well,
it's not really English. It's what's his face? Anyways, keep going.
Okay, so it becomes their mission that they know they have to take care of that ring one way or another, and that's when their mission starts, because the God Warriors decide to return to their path, to their respective places, because they know that the enemy is going to come to them. Athena stays in place trying to stop this event from transpiring, and the Bronze Saints start to march towards defeating their enemies. And that's how episode 75 ends.
Jackie, any thoughts on the episode?
Well, I guess Toy, for one thing, decided that it was time that Hugo needed a love interest, so I guess that's why they pair him up with Freddy to an extent.
He's always I ask this question every time, and I'm pretty sure I keep forgetting the answer. But how popular was Hyoga at the time with Japanese audience?
Very.
The second most popular character.
Because the thing was okay. First movie, he ends up having a really bad Tinder date with Eris. Second movie, he ends up in Asgard and gets brainwashed to become another soldier. Now he gets a love interest here. Like, Jesus Christ.
I applaud. They know where the butter's being used
in the bread. Keep going.
Sorry, I just lost it with the Tinder. I mean, you know, it's every hero has to have a pretty girl. So, and for Hyoga was the only one that hadn't gotten one of the enemies. So, if they figured they could do it in Aster. Other than that, what I did realize at the time that I see now, that this episode actually, when Hilda and her warriors arrive to where Athena is, you know, where the polar cap is melting. There is the whole sequence that everybody, fires up their Cosmo. It essentially sort of quickly previews the fights that you're going to see who versus who.
Mm-hmm. Like they're all sending off. They're like, ooh, they're all pointing fingers. Like, I'm gonna get you.
Yeah, it's like I'm gonna go after you and stuff like that.
I'm gonna see you later. I'm gonna punch you in the freaking face. I'm gonna get you.
But what? But then this is one of those episodes that also has like some random weird animation sequence in my opinion. What was it with the faces kind of like squished? Like the scenes, like it compresses the face. Like it's really weird. I don't even know how to describe it. But that one always bothers me. And I think we see that in Asgard a lot too. There's just every couple of episodes there's some random, really strange animation sequence, and all I can say is, what were they trying to accomplish with this? But yeah, I think that's pretty much that's what this episode does. I mean, animation looks nice. I don't know if it's alright. I can't really recognize who may have done the episode, but to me, I think the quality wise, it looks really good. And it really all it does is just set up what's going to happen. You know, Hyuga just, you know, I don't know if it was this. I can't remember if it was this episode or later explains that why he was there first in Asgard.
I think he said something like that, like in the previous episode. Like, I'm gonna go on ahead to Asgard in the previous episode. Just like how he was like, okay, I'm going to Lucio Peaks and I'm gonna talk to the Grand Master.
Yeah, they were trying to gather more information ahead of Athena's arrival. So I guess that's what we're seeing from the beginning. So it may not be quite clear what's going on. You know, of course, Freya explains the situation and so forth. And all it really is that one of those episodes that's just setting you up for what it's going to be about.
Yeah, I think like you know, my opinion, like Becca, you wanna go first?
No, go on ahead first, and then I'll go.
Okay, so, I mean, yeah, it's like, you know, we kind of established what the God Warriors can do in the previous episode. Here we're kind of establishing a little bit more of the setting itself, and kind of like previewing a little bit of who's gonna be fighting who in this fight. Even though there's some fights that are like, you know, they're not who they ended up being at the end of the day, but there's a lot of like that you get to see, like, you know, who they're gonna pick a fight with. My first major thought on the episode was like, hey, you know, what was, you know, I keep forgetting that Kyoga was like really popular, and that's why there's such a huge focus on him. And you know, it's a great way to set up the whole entire arc, in my opinion. A lot of stuff already that was already established by Jackie. She made a lot of great points on it. But overall, I thought the episode was fine. Like, it's a good way to like set up everything. It's not the best episode of the world. Again, like the last episode was unironically a episode to sell you on the toys. This is more of an episode to sell you on the setting and everything else. Because like now that we sold you on the toys, now we got to sell you on everything else, and slowly we're gonna start giving you breaking your heart. Because like I think this is what's more known about the series is these next couple of episodes. So yeah, I mean, I don't know what else really much to say other than like it's just a basic episode with it's just a basic setup episode. Like again, it sets up more the plot and gives us like the ticking timer. That's always kind of prominent in Saint Seiya, where it's like, but then again too, this is a narrative thing in general. Like, in order to add more suspense, you always have a ticking clock on anything. And like, this is not a fault of the story. It's not a fault of anything. This is basic writing 101. If you want to add tension, you have to have some sort of ticking clock attached to it. It's like there's so like, you know. It's like, you know, if people want to accuse the series of like not being original, it's like, no, this, like, you have, there's so many other series that have ticking time clocks and to add more tension to things. So it's like, no, like don't start accusing the series for them reusing a lot of things like that. I do find it interesting that's like, you know, that like, you know, she's that Athena is like, look, You're slacking your job here, Hilda. I gotta take over, because like if not the polar caps are gonna melt. So, like, let me do your job that you're slacking off to, man. other than that, you know, it's a fine episode. Like, it's a good episode to get. It's more of an episode to establish the theming of the episode, the theme of the theme and where they are going to be going for the next couple of episodes. Nikos, your thoughts?
Yeah, this episode is kind of weird in the sense that we've already pretty much made clear that the previous one is very good at kind of setting up the stage for this new story to unfold. But this episode immediately begins with Hyoga running away with with Freya. But we don't know that. Like in the beginning of this, it's like, because immediately it goes like, what the fuck is going on? And you would think that maybe like they would do something like, okay, they would do a time skip to go back in the past and explain how the hell Hyoga got there. Who the hell is this girl? And how the hell they got in touch together? Nope, they just skipped that. It's like, they never mentioned it. It's like, as far as we're concerned, Hyoga already did all the work. It's like, eh? That's very bizarre in terms of storytelling. That's something that will probably pop up again throughout this arc. But okay, that's a negative point that I have on this one. But then it gets to a very memorable scene. You can say that it maybe gets dragged way too long, but it is very memorable how like Hilda very menacingly approaches and the God Warriors with her, and on the opposite side, Saori with the three Bronze Age presence with her, especially because of the music. In this case, this is the first time that we hear this melody. Pardon me, I can't remember the name of the melody at the top of my head right now, but this is the first time that I can remember that we get introduced to this, and that would become a staple melody to be used in other parts of the series as well. So it's a very memorable scene, and the objective gets established. Like, this is like to establish, okay, what exactly is this saga? This is the objective to accomplish in this saga, and that's what the episode does. It's not like, I think that the way that you describe it is the best. It's not great, but it's not bad. It's fine. It's fine.
It does the job.
Exactly.
All right. Well, we'll go to our next episode then.
Okay. Do you mind if I actually do the synopsis for both episodes 75 and 76?
We might as well. Yeah.
To explain the reason why to the audiences, these two falling two episodes is basically just one prolonged episode, just like divided by half.
Yeah.
Episode 75 begins with episode 76. Begins with the Saints running towards the objective of reaching the palace and trying to find the way to take that ring from Hilda. While they're running, they face their first person that they need to defeat in order to be able to proceed, which is Thor, the god warrior of Fekda. He is the most imposing one out of all of them in terms of size, because he's a stupidly ass giant.
Mm-hmm.
Like he's big.
He towers everybody.
He towers everybody. So, and he's very big, and he wields Mjolnir, like two twin axes, but that he calls Mjolnir. That's kind of odd, because that never actually gets explained. Mm-hmm. Like what he's in, it never goes into depth too much about the relation to Norwegian mythology. But anybody that knows the name, well, you know what they're talking about.
There's four movies you can watch there's four movies you can watch about that. Anyways, keep going.
Okay, so the Bronze Saints start to attack him, Hyoga and Shun, and they fail miserably. He just wipes them out with one hit, and he makes them unconscious. Then it's up to Seiya to face him. Obviously, he gets pummeled. Then when he's lying on the ground, like half beaten to death, he starts to get an imaginary lesson with Meryn. He starts to remember his previous fights. He stands up. He starts to gain a little bit of territory and does a little bit of damage to Thor. Thor, this is Nabra. He stands back up again and then attacks Seiya again and throws him off a cliff. That's the end of episode 76. Episode 77 begins immediately after that with... Actually, Seiya having to have been rescued. No, he's like on the brink of falling, but he gets back up. Then he again attacks Thor. Thor says Nabra. Then again attacks him and sends him back onto the cliff. But by this time, Shiryu arrives and saves Seiya's ass. Then they climb back up again. Shiryu is about to face him, but Seiya says, No, you go ahead. I'll defeat him. And then Seiya gets his ass kicked again over and over until. And then when he stands up again, out of the blue, Thor starts to remember his past and the way that he became acquainted with Hilda, and shows us a little bit of how Hilda used to be before the possession by the ring, in which he was apparently like a thief trying to not starve in the horrible, horrible place that seems to be Asgard. He apparently even was hunting near the grounds of the castle, and they tried to arrest him, but he stood his ground. But then Hilda saves him from being arrested, and that's when he declares his loyalty to her. Then he faces off against Seiya, but because this is the point where he internally starts to doubt if maybe there is something wrong with Hilda, because he can see the change in her personality. But he goes against Seiya. Seiya finally is able to defeat him, and he falls down dead. And then they grab what will become a very important item in this saga, which is his his Odin sapphire is embedded into every single one of the god robes. And then they everybody proceeds to move on forward. And that's how episode 76 and episode 77 end.
Jackie, do you have any thoughts on the episode? Are these two episodes ending? Because,
it was just really okay. Of course, they had to have the first protagonist, you know, right? But it's true. You know that was going to happen. Protagonist must always be the first one to fight.
And get his
episode predicted it.
Yeah, keep going.
But, you know, okay, other than that, so this episode, you know, we know Seiya, his ass kicked, and then Shiryu arrived, but Shiryu at least does, you know, like he was able to get some information from Doko and essentially what they need to do to destroy and remove the
ring of the Nibelungen ring.
Nibelungen ring from
the language I was thinking was Swedish.
Anyways. But here's the thing, like, you know, of course when the whole thing begins, you're kinda thinking, okay, the good guys versus the bad guys. But what this episode also establishes is that it's telling us, you know, that the whole reason the God Warriors are fighting for Hilda is really because, you know, they believe in her good side. So it really makes you feel sorry for them because they're going to have to get defeated, but, you know, they're not bad guys, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
So once again, it's going to be one of those, you know, that this, of course, there's going to be action, there's going to be fights, but it's going to be a lot of tragedy too, because not all of them, mind you, but the majority, you know, believe, you know, they're loyal to Hilda because of her kindness and how she's treated them. But, you know, we'll get into the other God Wars later. But at least starting with Thor, he establishes that for the most part, that, you know, that they remain loyal to her no matter what, because, you know, she is a good person. We don't know what's controlling her at this point, and it's going to be a while before, you know, we find out. Other than that, you know, just, you know, was just a one, it's really one, what should have been one episode that was maybe stretched out a little too much. And I feel like that's going to be a problem with the one problem we have with this particular arc is some of the things get stretched out unnecessarily a lot. I mean, okay, how many times did Seiya need to get beat up so that we know, oh, he's getting beat up and, you know, Meryn needs to encourage him somehow? But
it is. Meryn's calling Collect. It's like, God damn, pick up the phone for God's sakes.
Oh, yeah. We didn't have cell phones, or I guess gospel cell phones, whatever you want to call it at the time. Anyway, that's all I really can contribute to this episode. And it sets us up for, you know, that the guys are separated, and who knows, they'll meet up later on again, and we'll just see a lot of separate fights for the time being.
Do you have any thoughts on the episode?
Thank you, Jackie. I actually forgot to mention those very important details about these episodes. The way that they learned that they require the Odin sapphires is because Doko did mention to Shiryu that the only way is by using the sword of Odin, which they can only acquire.
One quick thought. I was watching this dub in English, and I like how they're insinuating in a dub that, like, we're just gonna rip the ring out of our finger. It's like, yoink. Like, just go walk up to her, like, yoink, mine. But keep going.
Well, you gotta do what you gotta do, you know. That and also the part at the end where they actually decide to separate themselves because they need to cover, basically they know that they need to defeat all of them, so there's no point in them sticking together as a group. So those are actually very important aspects to this episode that I forgot to mention. Sorry about that. Anyways, to the episodes themselves, I actually agree with Jackie quite a bit on the sentiment that it feels that it was stretched out way too long, because, and the reason why I specifically decided to do the synopsis of both these episodes as back by back is because this could have been just one episode, but unfortunately, due to the particular reason why this saga needs to exist, which is to basically give Kurumada time to be able to publish more chapters of the manga. So you can, unfortunately, like, here's the thing, like, okay, it's a filler arc. There's no denying that, and that's its purpose. But you can start to see that, and you can start to feel that, and that's never
painfully.
Good. Yeah, that's
painful.
Never good. It's not as bad here. Like, it could have been a lot worse.
We've seen worse examples in this show.
Yeah. Like, it's not the worst in the entire series by far, but not by any means. But you can start to see this, and this is going to become a constant in this arc, unfortunately. So you can see the beginning of that here, and it's starting to become apparent so soon is not a good thing in my book. But at the very least, what I can say is that if anything, even though it feels a little bit of a drag, it is entertaining to see. It's always it's always, you know, nice to see Seiya getting the shit beaten out of him just for him to stand up. The one thing that I do have to criticize about this is that I do feel that Thor telling his origin story, let me address it as that, it feels way too out of left field. It was like really? Like, it was completely unnecessary, and he just starts to remember his past for no reason.
Well, he does have a reason, because he's like, he's feeling the cosmos of Athena, and he's like, I remember this feeling from Hilda.
Yeah.
That's how it's established too, with the Hilda guy.
Never mind, I stand corrected, but maybe it could have been... Okay, so there is a reason for it. Maybe it could have been done a bit better. That's all I can say on the matter then. That's basically my thoughts on it. Like, the episode was fine. It was entertaining, but you can start to see a bit of the dragging aspect of it. But, well, we'll get to see that more as we advance on the show.
Yeah, I have to agree with you guys. Like, the reason why I allowed you to put both episodes together was, like, yeah, I was about to say we had no choice to put these two episodes together. Like, it literally is like one entire episode put together in one dragged out fight that should have been done in like an episode at least. And yeah, like, it becomes very painfully obvious. Really, like, it becomes painfully obvious midway through the fight when he has to like call when he has to call up Marin. And then, like, he repeats, and they do the same thing twice. Like, okay, you got thrown off a cliff, climbed up again. Like, oh my god, how many times, how stupid are you, Seiya? For god's sake, I think this is where I got the idea that Seiya's a fucking idiot. Because he keeps repeating the same mistakes over and over again. And I guess this is when I started establishing, like, yeah, this boy just keeps on throwing stuff at the wall and praying that it works.
Actually, this also kind of becomes a repetitive thing throughout this arc that we start seeing a lot of things sound like, didn't you learn anything from your battles in 12 temples? You really start questioning.
The CTE from throwing yourself at Thor was that much, and you forgot how to fight this dude? I forgot how to fight this guy? Jesus Christ, dude. But the repetition starts to happen, but like there's some nuggets of interesting like things that would happen. Like, again, there's like you may have not caught Bankos, but I caught the fact that when he started feeling the cosmos of Athena when Seiya was powering up, I did like the fact like we got a glimpse of not just his origin, but also to like him noticing like, wait a minute, there's something wrong with Hilda, because like it cuts to another flashback immediately afterwards. So it's a flashback within a flashback. Or a flashback that fastens forward to it. And he's like, he starts to notice, like, I need you to capture Freya. But he's like, why would you want me to capture Freya? This is very particular. Something's not right about this lady that I'm working with now. So you can tell the gears in his hair are starting to like grind a little bit. I was like, something's not right. And it's something that's like, it's quite sad. Like, it's quite unfortunate with the saga. It's like, this saga is known to be one of the better filler sagas in anime history, but it's also like one of the more tragic ones, and we get to see a lot of that tragedy kind of play out. And like, you know, because like Thor is, you know, he's only doing these things for like to help out others. Because he said, like, yeah, I'm trying to make sure that the people in my village don't die. And it's like, yeah, fine. And Hilda's like, okay, good. You're doing something good. I'll let you go. And like he feels that warmth, and that's really cool that they established that. And also establishing too, it's like something's not right with Hilda now that she put the Nibelungen ring on her again, and she's acting kind of weird. So it's really cool that like the god warriors are like they're kind of cognitive as if something's going on with Hilda. And like we get to see later on with like how different gold warriors kind of react to that. Also, like I said, like again, while I was watching it dubbed, they kind of like insinuate with the dialogue. It's like we're just gonna rip the ring out of her finger and see what happens. Like the fucking one ring from Lord of the Rings. But that's not how it works. And it's like she was like, no, dude. You took too many bullets in the head. You gotta like listen to me, man. We gotta rip. You're taking too many blows to the head. We have to use Odin's sword to break him out.
Yeah, but you cannot get mad at Say. I mean, how many times did he get punched in the head? Like there's obviously gonna be some brain damage there.
Again, CTE. but overall, I do find that we're gonna see a little bit more of the tragic backstory to a lot of these characters, and like it's like. On one hand, like it's great that we had these fleshed out characters in this kind of type of an arc, and because like I can point you to some of the worst filler we've seen ever by going back to the Silver Saints arc, where it's like here's Silver Saint of the day, guy who's Spider Dude, not related to Spider Man. But here, at least you get like, okay, Thor is a compassionate person. He wants to fight for the people like in his village, and he finds Hilda, you know, like he finds this aura like very welcoming, and he starts to notice like something's not right about her, and it's really good that we kind of have like that kind of establishment. Did it really need to have two episodes? No, but it's great that they're putting in those nuggets of everything into the episode. I will say this. If push does come to shove, and we do notice like all together that these episodes like tend to blend in together, like this again, I will allow us to do two episodes at a time and do it in this style. I think the previous episode too was kind of like that too, where it's like we kind of got a preview of like the characters of like we kind of got the new toy thing, and we got kind of like an establishment of the. Of the setting, so I think like a little bit. So it does feel too like they kind of wrote these as one prolonged episode that could have been like one episode, but they just had to do it in two. I just think in the previous episode they did a better job at disguising that, but once I'm putting things together, it starts to make a little bit more sense. Does anybody have any final thoughts on these episodes?
Nope, good here.
Me too. I think we've covered them pretty well.
All right.
Yeah.
All right, then. I think it's a good place to stop here. It was a really good conversation. Really good episode to come back to. It was really refreshing to start doing the show. Really, really good to experiment with what we're doing here on Twitch as well. I'll tell you guys later on off stream. But we had a really good audience up here for the show. So thank you for sticking by here.
Thank you, everybody.
Really do appreciate it. Thank you very much. Like this experiment was a success, so I really do appreciate that. So, but hey, we have to go. So, why don't we do our usual plugs for things? Becca, why don't you start us off with anything you would like to promote?
Alrighty. Currently, I did take a little bit of a time off. I haven't been active too much online, but don't worry. I do intend to start doing a few stuff here and there in the near future. You can find me at my Twitter, which is at MexicanGeek502. Or you can also find me at my Instagram, which is Crateris Benches. I'm going to try to be a little bit more active here. I do have a couple things that I planned. I have an idea for my following drawing. And I intend to, finally, after putting it way too long, I'm going to translate into English chapters 3 and 4 for Re-Rise of Poseidon. So please look forward to that.
All righty. Jackie, do you have anything you would like to promote? Anything you'd like to bring up before we go?
Oh yeah, I guess I should go ahead and promote my socials. I'm in Twitter at Flower Miko. Pretty simple. One word. And I know things have been a little bit iffy with Twitter, so I'm going to see if I start, like, looking through my social, other socials that I use and see if I can, you know, set up a backup account or something. But for right now, the best way to find me is at Flower Miko. Then I'm going to go ahead and promote my translator friend one more time.
Please do.
Yes, my Tomo-chan, she is at Sweet Dream Life Zero. For your translation needs, please hit her up. I mean, she is amazing. She can do Japanese to English or Japanese to Spanish as well. I think she might be open up to it, translating. But, you know, just check with her. And I might be working with her. Actually, I am working with her, something along the lines of Santa Show. So, but, you know, I'll let you guys know when it's ready.
Can't wait to hear it. Because I'm pretty sure. After the last episode we did with Maru de Cinco, and you guys were just going back and forth and knowing how much stuff you got, like how much stuff you have of the Saintia show, it's. I want to know more. You're like the North Star of like Saintia show right now for English speakers, and like it would be great if you can have like a little bit more information, open up a little bit.
That's where, you know, my main like passion project within Saint Seiya is with Santa Show. So
yeah,
I'm gonna keep working on that.
I'll talk to you later about something, but it's really cool. I'm about to talk to you about. As for me, okay, first and foremost, just like Bankas, I've been kind of out of it because I've been out on vacation. Well, I want to say vacation. I needed some personal time out. I need some PTO. So I took a month off. In that month off, I decided to start taking up gunpla making. So if you want to see me do gunpla and like model kit making in general, follow my Twitch, twitch.tv/lrantis84. Not only am I gonna do live streams of these episodes of CosmoCast, but also too you can find me just working on gunpla or just playing a random game there as well. But most likely it's gonna be gunpla, and usually it's me learning how to paint. You know, there's a person in the chat there that's been a great inspiration for me. They've been helping me a lot on trying to improve on my skills of painting, and they're sort of like my, you know, they're sort of like my reason why I'm also trying to take up a little bit more hand painting and stuff like that as well. So if you're there, you know who you are. Thank you so much. Of course, I have another podcast. I have the Saturday Morning Squadron. We're taking a brief hiatus because, well, one, it was my hiatus, and two, the problem is that my other host Rob, he's currently out at the moment. So we may be a little bit, because like he's going to conventions out in Australia. He actually got to meet Toto Fuya at his last convention, so that's really cool that he got to meet him. So, you know, when we come back, I think we're gonna have like a huge discussion, because like I think we're planning to do something post San Diego Comic Con, and I think we're gonna talk about his experiences and my experiences at San Diego Comic Con. So I think that's the plan when we come back eventually, sometime before the end of July. So as I said before, I'm gonna be at San Diego Comic Con this year. San Diego Comic Con is gonna be between July 16th to the 20th. I'm gonna be hosting a panel there. I'm not 100% sure. I'm not 100% sure if I can announce it or not, because like it's not officially on record. We got the confirmation that it's not on like anything yet. But we do know. I can tell you that we are doing a panel there at the show. And yes, it is labeled under a CosmoCast thing. It is something CosmoCast related as well. So I can't wait to talk about that. I can't wait to talk about it when the time comes before I go off to do that. Like I said, like if any news breaks at San Diego Comic Con, I will be there to talk about it. And I will be I'll try my best to do my things there as well. And good news is it falls on a week that we're not recording. So it's... So those kinds of little episodes have one benefit. It's like, hey, it's not gonna disrupt our flow episodes that we got going in. Yeah. Of course, if you want to find this, you can find the show at sccosmocast.com. Again, the address is sccosmocast.com. You can find us on Twitter, which is again at sccosmocast. Depending if Twitter has not burned completely to the ground just yet, it might be by the time this episode goes up, who knows? But if something does happen, we do have a Discord. if you want to join our Discord channel and, you know, talk to the fans and talk to us, you're more than welcome to. I'm very active there. I know you two are kind of out and out, but that's fine. You know, I'm like my thing, really. It's actually more me and Rob's thing. It's more Rob's than mine. But I tend to do a lot of housekeeping stuff, and he's really cool with all the stuff I do here on that Discord. So if, like, push us come to shove, there's a Discord. You can find the links to all our socials, so everything that we have to on the show notes, on the website. You know, just like, and like, you know, if Twitter's not completely imploded, like, you can find that info also on Twitter as well. Alrighty, my friends, time to go. For Bankos and for Jackie, I am Ramses, and I'm here to tell you to keep burning that cosmos. I will see you next time. Bye.
Thank you very much. Bye.